Hi, everybody. It's Gene Simmons, and you're not, and you're listening to the Potter Than Hell podcast with Steve, BC, BB, and Dylan. But you knew that, didn't you?
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Potter Than Hell podcast. This is your last stop on the crazy train of hard rock and heavy metal. So sit back, buckle in, and hang on. Here we go.
Hello there, Potter Than Hellions. Welcome back to the Potter Than Hell podcast. This is Steve, your host, and across from me today is
BC.
And on his left is
BB.
And across from him on two sets of keyboards tonight is
Dylan.
One set is not working, though, right?
Yep.
It's almost it's like the double bass. You got double keys.
Oh, there you go.
Oh, yeah. On the double keys.
He's like, Jeff Downs. He's got them surrounded. So welcome back, everybody. Hope everybody's doing good out there. We just had a major snowstorm here in the northeast of Pennsylvania where we are. It sucked ass. Rain snowed for fucking 3 days here. Pain in the balls. But we survived, and here we are. It's actually a pretty nice evening out there, which is unusual for us recording here. And how's everybody doing? How you doing, BB?
Good, and funny you say that because the three of us thought we were supposed to record the blizzard night, and thank God for Dylan. You know, not only is the keys, but he's pretty much our almost like the babysitter. Hey, jackasses, we're not recording tonight. We're recording Thursday. We're like, oh.
In my defense, BC is on a different shift now, so I had everything scheduled. And I did the same thing to BC because I was going to change my schedule too. So I had him fucked up changing the work schedule. So then I had the stuff changed on the podcast, and then I decided not to change shifts, and then another guy did, and then BC changed shifts, so then I had to change it two more times. And
so we're not sure what the schedule is anymore.
Yeah, so I think I got it down.
I'm just saying, you make us check the band app, and then it's not
and
even
it's
right.
Wrong. No, I know. It should be good, though. It should be good. When we're done, I'm going to go over it and make sure that we're all on the same page, okay? So how are you, BC? How's it going, buddy?
Tired, but going good, though.
Good. How about you, Dylan? I know what your answer is going to be, but go ahead.
It's been better. It's been better having computer issues with my personal computer, and it's very frustrating. But
what do we call it?
Technology.
Dylan said, fuck you, Apple.
Yeah.
Fuck you, Apple.
DC said, it's technology.
See, now, if it was my computer, it'd probably be all plugged up with porn, but I don't think Dylan's is.
No.
Which mine is not. I do all my porn on my iPad. So I keep it off the computer. And we had Mark Anthony Cann last week. We did a little Whitesnake playlist, and that was fun. Always cool talking about Whitesnake, which we talked about. I can't believe we hadn't done a Whitesnake episode since we've been going.
No, and there's tons of material out there.
Definitely.
Tons of them didn't we know about.
Unbelievable. I can't wait to actually get into those albums down the road with Mark, because There's some good stuff way in the back catalog.
Yeah, and the thing for me is, and I told BC the other day, I said, I have to stop buying fucking records. I'm like, as we started doing the White Snake stuff.
That lasted 10 minutes.
Yeah.
I know.
He bought three records after 10 minutes after you said that.
10 minutes after you said it, he's like, oh, I just bought.
I got the deal live.
I said something like, look above, like the last text.
I know. I'm like, well, I almost made it through the day without ordering a vinyl, but then
it came up.
There was like six of them left, so I had to fucking get one. So, but there's certain bands that I want all the stuff. So, and Dio is one of them. So, so Whitesnake's gonna be cool. And actually, today we're recording. It's the 4th of February, and I want to say happy birthday to Alice Cooper. He's 73 today, and I like how Alice Cooper copies off of me, because he uses the same brand of golf clubs that I do.
Ooh.
So that's okay, though. We both use Callaway, but actually he's endorsed by them. I am not. I must pay for my golf clubs, which I did get two new hybrid clubs from my family for my birthday. Thank you, Dylan, and my wife, Corey, and Carson. Thank you.
And you know, as probably when Dylan interviewed him, he probably asked, you know, what type of golf clubs did your dad use?
And I gave away the secret. Sorry.
Yep. Yeah, see that? Callaway, good clubs. All right. So happy birthday, Alice. Like I said, he's 73, and we just did the Alice Live album, I don't know, I think two episodes ago. Dude's doing good for a 73-year-old dude, and he's got an album coming out in March. I think it's called Detroit Stories.
Detroit Stories.
But we're waiting to see who he actually recorded with, because I don't know if he recorded with his live band or if he did this thing with the studio dudes like he did on the last one that he did. So that's going to be cool.
It's actually coming February 26th.
Oh, is it? Oh, okay. I thought it was March. Yeah. Cool. Even better. So that'll be next week, I think, when you guys are listening to this, I believe. I can't start thinking about days because that gets me all fucked up. All right. So what are we listening to, my friends? I'll come to you last, Dylan, because you're a little flustered there. So, BB, what do you got going?
Well, BC will be very happy with me. I even sent him an actual pick for this episode, but he didn't use it. So I'm never going to do that again. But
nice try.
I've been stuck in the Vain realm. I've listened to No Respect, All Those Strangers, Enough Rope, Rolling with the Punches. It's just a one day at work. I just let the whole Apple Music just roll through the whole catalog. And great stuff. Great stuff. If nobody's ever heard these guys, they're definitely a fantastic band to get into, and really, really good stuff.
Yeah, and we did No Remorse with Tom, I think. Was it Tom? Was it Tom?
No Respect.
Or Zeus? No Respect. What did I say? No Remorse. Okay.
Yeah, not Metallica.
No Respect. I don't know. With Tom or Zeus we did that one with.
One of the
It must have been Tom.
I think it was Tom.
Tom. I never heard of
it. Yeah. Because it was, I think it was Zeus that actually kind of liked Pretty Boy Floyd.
Yep. That's it. Yeah.
I think they each kind of liked one that we didn't think they were going to like. So, all right, Vane, cool. How about you, BC?
The new Accept. I have that. And new is Michael Schenker. I know that goes under MSG.
I think it's just MSG now, yeah.
50th anniversary. Is that, I mean, but the Accept has been in the player and it hasn't come out.
Okay, Dylan, what do you got?
I've been listening to a couple things. The first thing I listened to is a new Royal Blood song called Typhoons. Very cool, groovy song. They just have such good riffs that I really enjoy. I really like the chorus of the song, too. But I also started checking out the Dead Daisies new album. And though I am missing John Corabi, it is pretty good. I am really enjoying it so far. But I keep thinking, what would it sound like with Corabi on vocals?
Not as good.
Oh, stop.
All right. And for me, and actually, one of the things I listened to the other day, actually, BC sparked my interest to it. I'll throw this one on every now and then. The classic album, you cannot go wrong with it. Queensryche, Operation Mindcrime. Classic, epic album. Absolutely fantastic. And it had been a while since I listened to that all the way through, so I just threw it on and let it go. Nothing to skip on there, even like Electric Requiem and stuff like that. Like, just totally fits in there. And Bruce Dickinson even said after they did Seventh Son and he listened to Mindcrime, he said that he wished that they did this, not Seventh Son. I mean, Seventh Son is okay, but I love Maiden, but it's no fucking a Mindcrime. You know, I don't know how people feel about that one way or another. I also have been listening to the new Accept. Fantastic. New Dead Daisies, I absolutely love. It's going to take something really spectacular to knock that out of my top five for the whole year. Love Glenn Hughes. He is my bucket list guy to meet and just, you know, say hello to. Fucking fantastic. And like I like John Corabi, but I'm so happy to see Glenn Hughes in a band that we're actually going to have a chance to see. Although we did see him in BC solo when he did the Deep Purple stuff, which was fucking phenomenal.
That was a good show.
And I listened to Little House of Lords the other day. Somehow that got stuck in my head, and you may hear from them a little bit later on as well. So what we got going this week, some House of Lords, Queensryche, and New Accept, and Dead Daisies for myself. Accept in the new MSG for BC. I listened to about half of the MSG. I liked it. I'm not sure if I liked the vocals a whole lot. It kind of was like, but I think I got to listen to it a little more. But the music was fantastic. BC had a vein going in his vein. Dylan was listening to the new Royal Blood song, Typhoons. So is that from a new album coming out?
Yeah, I think so, yeah.
Okay.
Because that's coming out, I think, in the middle of the year.
Okay, cool. Yeah, those guys are cool, too. Dylan's also Dead Daisies. And so that's what we got going. And before we do, we're going to do something that totally forgot about last week that we're trying to work into the show. I totally fucking dropped the ball and forgot about it. So we're going to give it another shot this week, and here's Random Thoughts from Sonny H. Pooney.
The Potter Than Hell podcast presents Random Thoughts with Sonny Hollywood Pooney.
Random Thought. you first kissed comes to you and says, I'm dying, and my last wish is to sleep with you, what do you do? What do you do?
Okay, Sonny. Thanks for that one. I was just like, what the fuck? What do you do, BC?
This is a trick question.
It is. It is.
Oh, she was a redhead, so they're crazy. So. If it's currently, I say no.
What's wrong with redheads?
They're crazy.
Well, you have a problem with
awesome,
me?
Awesome, though.
Huh? You have a problem with me?
Women.
I just proved your point. Like, he, like, you know what I mean? Like, there, ooh, see,
gonna kick your ass.
I hate this disparagement of gingers. It's
I love redheads. I fucking love redheads. What about you, BB?
I don't know.
Although BC didn't really give an answer.
Yeah, I'm gonna have to say who's number two on the list. Maybe they can go to number two on the list.
I'm gonna try to go the hall pass route. Sonny, next time I come on one of your shows, that's what I'm gonna ask you. How about you, Dylan?
So, it's interesting because I'm gonna start off by saying I probably wouldn't, but it's interesting because the first person I kissed, like, we're still really good friends with. Me and my current girlfriend, and it would be a really interesting conversation.
Some good stuff could happen there.
My instinct is no, but you know, I don't know. It'd be very strange.
So
I'll pose that to Christine. See, not to ask that it's okay, but just be like, what would be your reaction in that situation if she did come up to me and say that? I think that's a good thought experiment too. Like, what would your current wives think?
Right. The pony social experiment.
Pony social experiment.
Because I feel like I would have to tell Christine about it, because that's just like,
oh yeah, yeah.
I had the weirdest thing happen to me today.
Okay, that Sonny. I think we should change it from the mind of pony. Okay, so there's Sonny's random thought of the week. He probably has about 1,000 of them that we probably can't even put on the air, for as much as we curse and shit on here. All right, so as you see from the title, is it going to be called what the playlist was titled now?
Yes.
Okay. So all's fair in love and war, right?
Mm-hmm.
So we're going to talk about, we each picked 5 songs that are about war or have war in them, and then 5 songs that are about love or have the word love in them. We did our scientific method out of BB's hat once again. And Dylan, you got the first 5. What do you got tonight?
Are we starting with war or are we starting with love?
We're starting with war because we want to end on a good note.
Yeah, I was tempted to pick war. What is it good for? Good God, y'all! But
the
I
Bruce Springsteen version, of course.
There's no good version of that. I think I would take that one over the regular one though.
I had a little difficulty picking the war songs. Can see, one of them I had to kind of fudge the rules a little bit, but it's still, you know, war themed.
He has my DNA.
So the first song that I picked was off of a covers album by Children of Bodom. Skeletons in the Closet is the album. A cover of Suicidal Tendencies, War Inside My Head. Very good thrash song, done very well by these guys. Cool keyboard stuff for a solo at one point that really switches it up a little bit. I really love this album as a whole. They cover Britney Spears, they cover Pat Benatar, the Ramones, they cover Poison, Alice Cooper, actually, they do Bed of Nails, fantastic cover of that song. But I picked War Inside My Head by Suicidal Tendencies, done by Children of Bodom. Next song, this is a song that if ever a zombie apocalypse were to occur and I had to pick a playlist of songs to have to, you know, crack zombie skulls, I'd have to go with this song as the top of the playlist from Pantera's Vulgar Display of Power album, Mouth for War. I mean, the album cover itself has a guy getting punched in the face. So what else could you say? It's got that aggression to it. The really great riffs from Dimebag. I love Phil Anselmo's Ripper. You know, the growl voice, and there's a nice time change towards the end that just goes on a rampage. Very, very cool. So I had to pick that. And then of course I follow up the most aggressive song that I have on my playlist with the least aggressive song that I have on my playlist. from Blue Oyster Cult, Fire of Unknown Origin, Veteran of the Psychic Wars. This is a nice little ditty that is kind of a little more reflective about these, imaginary wars that are happening, and it almost has kind of a melancholic feel to it, a little sadness attached to it. Like, the guy doesn't really want to be fighting in the psychic war, so it's kind of the opposite side of war. Very cool guitar work, though, from Buck Dharma. I really enjoy it, and I really love the vocals. They very much sell the song to me. Next up, I have from Volbeat, a band that me and Dad love. Of course, the first words you hear in the song are, "Let's get ready to rumble!" Warrior's Call. This is one of their classic songs. I think this is probably one of their, if not their signature song. Just got the great riffs and the iconic vocals with that. Nobody has a vocal tone like the lead singer of Volbeat. You could very much tell it's him with a fire in the rain. It just iconic, and it's a good song. I always love Volbeat. And then I ended up with my boys from Bolt for my Valentine off of their album Venom. You want a battle? Here's a war. Some cool chanting in it. It's a little bit of more of a mid-tempo song for them, which I don't think is too bad. But I like Bullet when they're fast and in your face. But this is a really good mid-tempo song for them that they really showcase their more melodic side. There's still some screaming in it, but good riffs and a very good kind of anthemic song for the band. So those are my war songs. I was going to also put Indians on there for the war dance, I decided not to talk about Anthrax this episode.
Yeah, great list. War Inside My Head from Children of the Bodom. The night me and BC almost got killed. Just love the heavy groove grind sound that these guys have. A little keytar in there. Can't forget about the keytar these guys use. Definitely better than a Suicidal Tendency song, that's for sure. Next one, Mouth the War by Pantera. Like you said, Phil's vocals are just so recognizable. Dime's playing is awesome. The next one may be the peace song of the list. You know what I mean? Like, it's almost like you got two great left and right punches, then this one kind of comes down. The Veteran of the Psychic Wars.
Yeah, Veteran of the Psychic Wars. Yeah.
When I saw BOC, it kind of it threw like a wrench in my head. I don't know why, but it was all right. I think out of the five, I think this is probably my least favorite song that you picked. Mm-hmm. Song number four, A Warrior's Call by Volbeat. This is a great pick. I have to start getting into Volbeat. I never heard the song before. I love the vocals. I love the chugging guitar. The drums sound amazing. And at the end, I said, I have to start listening to Volbeat. Great pick. And song number five, You Want a Battle, Here's the War by Both for My Valentine. Another great band. But I think, BC, you were the first one to bring those guys. Didn't we listen to them on a trip to one of the Kiss Expos? Probably the first one or two albums.
Who?
Bullet for My Valentine.
Bullet? I don't know. We were going somewhere and you had Bullet, and I don't think we ever heard of them before. And they.
What year was the first album called?
2005?
Yeah, because it's on a playlist for one of our future episodes.
So maybe it wasn't a Kiss Expo.
It was 2005, 2006. It's one of those.
2005?
Yeah,
we were going somewhere.
I got into them during Scream Aim Fire, personally.
In M3, maybe?
M3?
Maybe. I don't know. You had the first. You had one of the first two albums, because I have the first two albums, and we were going somewhere. And you were like, here, check these guys. You threw it in the.
Yeah. I don't remember.
But yeah, another great band. I love during the song when they scream, "Here's a war." I love when they get into it.
Yeah.
And the singer's like, "Here's a war." The double bass drums are so cool, and the band harmonies are fantastic. But yeah, definitely a very, very good list. All Blue Oyster Cult. I have to.
That was a knee-jerk reaction pick, I have to admit.
Yeah, the war songs were tough to find.
Was that song on the heavy metal soundtrack? I know Bloister Cult had a...
That's a good question.
Had a song on that soundtrack, and I'm wondering if that was it. For some reason, I don't know. I'm probably wrong, but Dylan's going to check that out. I'll go next, because then I'll be... So, War Inside My Head. I'm listening to this. I've heard it 1,000 times, and I really like this. I like the version. It's cool, and for some reason, when I'm listening to this, there's parts, it sounds exactly like fucking Anthrax doing this song.
Yeah.
It really does. It really gets really,
Especially
and,
the,
and, I'm,
like
and, I'm,
the,
and I'm thinking this isn't a fucking Anthrax song.
Especially
the, and I'm like, I know it's not.
That's what I even wrote.
Yeah.
I didn't
like
say
the,
it, but
the
I wrote it.
Inside my head, that
yeah, because like the background vocals yeah. are very Scott Ian-ish, I yeah. think. You know what I mean? Very, very cool version of that song. Mouthful of War. I love the the drums and the guitar and the bass in the beginning of that song. Just you're like, this song's gonna fucking kick ass. And I thought, whoa! Like the vocals are so distinct on this one, and this is like you do want to recreate that fucking album cover when you hear this song. Just punch someone in the face. Love it. Veteran of Psychic Wars, and Dylan didn't inform me. Yes, that that song was on the soundtrack for the heavy metal movie, and I like it. It's got the marching kind of drums, the kind of a little "We Will Rock You" feel to the like the parts during the verses. I don't hate it. It's not bad. It's very atmospheric because you have the keyboards in the background kind of are a little woo kind of deal. Warriors Call Volbeat. It's got the fight. I really like them. There's some cool grindage in that. I love their melodies. Volbeat has fantastic melodies, and they got smashed for their last album they had. I thought it was fucking fantastic. You can't go wrong with Volbeat as far as I'm concerned. You want a battle? Here's a war. This song, I don't know. I like it, but I hate it. The chanting reminds me of that shitty Sonic Youth song or whatever the fuck we did on that one thing.
Oh, the POD Youth of Addiction.
Yeah, that's what those...
We are,
vocal.
We are.
Yeah, that's what it reminded me of. I was like, oh, dude, like, what the fuck? But
much better than that. Come on.
But, I mean, there's some glimpses of, like, double bass drums in there, and, like, the chanting just, like, totally throws me off. But not bad, though. I like that. And actually, that one is the only little skip in the record for me is the children chanting on that one. But the production is fantastic on the song, though. The production is great, especially when it gets into those the little double bass parts. And I like it, too, because it's broken up. It's not through the whole song. So I like it.
It's always Dylan's songs. It's always Dylan's songs that make me want to, like, the Void beat. I mean, how many times I keep saying I'm going to check these guys out more, and I never do. But I got to do that and the Children of Bottom. Maybe it's because the near-death experience that we had kind of makes me shy away from it.
A little bad flashbacks.
But I love that. That was a good pick, good song, the grindage. Pantera, how can you go wrong with Pantera? Great album. Classic and nowadays. And, of course, Bullet for my Valentine. I mean, I was into these guys way back in the day.
I'm telling you, I don't know why I remember. Like, there's just certain songs, and I think it was one of your big black Escalade you had, and you were driving, and I was in the back, and Dylan may have even been with me. I don't even know.
Masters Rock, there.
M3.
Thank you. It had to be that.
Like, who the fuck are these?
Because I took that down.
Like,
we took that down to a new band
you found somewhere somehow.
Probably.
We've literally gone
M3 for 10 years.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But you had that album the first couple
heavy.
Years.
And then it seems like they get a little bit different. Like the music changes with the time.
Yeah.
For me, their first three albums are my favorite because you have The Poison, Screaming Fire, and then Fever, which Fever is my favorite. Fever's fantastic.
Then you got a little.
I mean, Temper's good, and then you have Venom, which isn't bad. But this last album, Gravity, was not my favorite. Wasn't a big fan. They got a little more commercial with that album.
I think a little too like slick of production, maybe.
Yeah.
On parts. Yeah, too much sprinkle dust on it.
Yeah, I agree. Who's next?
Oh, that was, okay. I thought he wasn't done. Did you do all of them?
Yeah, you said Bullet was the last song.
Okay,
it was.
All right. See that? I've been fucking up and only after one person went. All right, my love songs. I'm starting out with
war.
How about you do your war songs?
Oh, war. Okay, see that? Jesus Christ.
That's it.
But take it away.
Honestly,
let's start from the beginning.
I just started my second beer. I swear to God. All right, I'm gonna go with an album from last year. Our buddy Tony Masalem from the great band Restrained. Their title track from the album that they put out last year, God of War. Fantastic album opener. It's got a very Iron Maiden-like galloping beginning to it. It's got some fantastic like harmonies in it. The Johnny Erstrain's vocals are fantastic. Tony throws out like an absolute shredding solo. But what I like about it is it really fits the song. And you guys know, and I'm going to talk about a song later that the solo doesn't fit the fucking song. But like, it's very melodic, and the production is really good on it. I'm glad they put this album out. And there, if you guys have not checked out Restrained, it's Restrayned.
Find out what it means to me.
Find out what it means. Okay, I'll ask Tony. And check them out, though. Seriously, they kick ass. They have a lot of. I think this is their third full album, and then I think they have an EP in there as well. But just really good melodic hard rock, you know, straightforward stuff. Really good, really catchy. My next song is going to be, actually, this album came out this year, but it's a song that was on an EP from a couple of years ago. And this band played M3 a couple times, BC, Kicking Valentina.
Okay.
They played M3 a bunch of times. They were one of, like, the first bands, like, on the Friday night or something like that. Really good melodic hard rock band. The song is called War. But it's got the hey hey's and the whoa whoa's in it. Yep. I am fucking all in.
You're in. No, I really know why
cool
you picked
melodic.
It.
It's got, the song's got a really, really good groove to it. And in the chorus, like, got a mouth, I think it's a mouth like a war. And it kind of makes you think you got a mouth like a whore.
That's what it sounds
That's
like.
That's what it
yeah.
sounds like. Yeah. But it's really good. And the next one, I did War and Peace from the 2010 Oracle album from Godsmack. Very heavy song. A lot of grinding in it. I love how it kind of, once you do the da-na-na-na-na-na-na-na for the, like, right before the chorus, and, like, it kind of soars right into the chorus. Whoa! Like, it just kind of perfectly melds right into the chorus of it. Fantastic song. And what am I going to do next here? I'm going to do the song War of Words from Fight. I got the wrong year on that one. From the War of Words album from Fight, Rob Halford's solo project, along with Scott Travis in it. Starts
Satchel?
Out.
Huh? Satchel?
Yeah. Yeah. Satchel and Metal Mike, right?
No.
No?
Yeah, I think Metal Mike's in that one.
Is he?
I think Satchel's so. Actually in that.
Okay. No, Russ. There's a...
Oh,
No, it's another guy.
No, that's Russ. Russ Parrish is Satchel.
The other guy. Real angry looking guy. I know it's not Metal Mike.
There's Brian Tilsey.
That's it.
Okay. And then Russ Parrish.
Okay.
Which, who is Satchel?
Okay. With Satchel and was it
Brian Tilsey?
Brian Tilsey.
I learned something.
Okay.
Did not know that.
Yeah. Metal Mike comes in later. He's more with Halford.
He was Halford.
Okay.
Dude.
Yeah. Okay. Just a cool song. Just War of War. Like, the Scott Travis's drums is fantastic on this. Really heavy element. And seriously, if you're a Priest fan and you've not heard Fight, it's a title track from the album War of Words. What year did that come out, Dylan?
It was 93.
Yeah, okay.
Ding, ding,
that
ding,
was
ding,
the year
ding,
I started at the Firehouse.
Even Volbeat's talking about the band at Warrior's Call. Fight.
Yeah,
Fight.
Just a great album, great debut album from that band. The second album, and actually this weekend I saw the second album, Small Deadly Space, on vinyl, and I was like, I didn't want it, so I took a picture of BC. Like, he's like, I don't really like it. I'm like, okay, so it sat on the rack. But the first Fight album is absolutely fantastic.
I don't know what that came out.
It was totally different from the first one.
Way different, and I think we're so in love with the first one that you're expecting something.
You're expecting like part two of it, yeah. and it's not part two of it. It's something totally different. Next song, love these guys. Absolutely love these guys. My last song, it's called Great War. Title track from the Sabaton album from 2019. This is a big, big sounding song. It's got that symphonicness to it, but the verses have a great pace to it, and then it kicks up for the solo. The production on it is amazing. I had this song on, and it was actually the last one I listened to before I left the house tonight, and I was like, I want to listen to the rest of the fucking album. I just absolutely love that symphonic stuff. And the big choruses with the, like, it's kind of like a choir with the big choruses, but it's metal and it's fucking fantastic. Love it. Dylan.
I liked all these songs. I liked your war songs better than I liked your love songs. So I'm happy we're talking about them. I do like some of your love songs, but I was just saying I like all.
Overall.
Yeah. I mean, the ones that really stuck out to me, War, the Kick and Valentina, really good song. That really jumped out at me. War of Words, I like that he recites the First Amendment at one point. You know, you don't get many songs that talk about petitioning the government or redressing grievances. You know, it helps. It makes me feel good that I, at one point, had to learn that by heart when I was studying journalism, and then hearing it in a Halford song. Great War, I feel like it really captures what it must feel like to have been in World War One. Just that fear and that, am I going to get through this? Like, this is, we're doing this for glory, but it's, you know, it's not a great place to be. Like, that epicness really helps sell that, and it does feel like the war to end all wars in the way that they really portray it in this song. So I was really taken away by that song. It painted a really good picture for me.
The whole album's like that.
Yeah, I could see that. I'll have to check those guys out, because it was really, at first I wasn't digging the guy's vocals, but then it really went with the song as it went on. I was getting more and more used to it. So
it kind of sounds like a drill sergeant would be singing it.
Yeah, yeah, he has that almost gruffness to it that almost took me out of it, because it was so different from the music. Mm-hmm. But it really worked. I think for it. But these were really good stretch of songs, for sure.
Yeah, great list. Start off with God of War from Restraint. I'm glad you picked them, because I see with Tony with Sonny and Tom and Zeus and those guys, and I really mean to actually listen to the Restraint albums. I think their harmonies are great. The guitar work is fantastic. The drums in it were really, really prominent for me. I really love the drum section of that song. War from Kickin' Valentina. Like the heavy groove of the song. Definitely a little bit different. Guitar work is great. Song number three, War and Peace from Godsmack. Love Godsmack. I love Sully's vocals. Super heavy groove. You know, definitely you could tell when you put this song on, you know it's Godsmack. It's definitely, you know, right in their wheelhouse. Fantastic, super heavy, grindage song. Song number four, War of Words from Fight. Love the high-pitched Rob Halford shit. Love it. Awesome guitar work in this. And it's funny, I never knew Satchel was his guitar player.
Oh, yeah.
I learned something today. And song number five, it's funny, in the text you wrote, Great Watt, said a great war.
Did I really?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm like, great.
Another great Watt.
Fucking what? Typo.
What?
Ham hands typing shit out.
Now, how do you say that band? Sabaton?
Sabaton, yeah.
Sabaton.
They're like fucking Irish pirates, righty. They're Irish pirates. Very theatrical. They sound just like there's 30 singers singing at the same time in the chorus. It's like, how many fucking people are in this band? There's like 30 of them on stage singing.
They bring that. They bring those people on stage.
Oh, man. It definitely different. I know you're in. I know you're big into this. This is definitely a different sound. Like that's all how we can describe it, is Irish pirates. But yeah, great list. I can't even pick on you about the Great Watt.
The Great Watt.
The Great Watt.
Sorry about that.
It's the Great Watt, Charlie Brown.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Restrained. I mean, this is by far one of the best CDs I got last year. I mean, this sounds bad, but I was surprised. I mean, this is really good CD. The song kicks ass. The whole CD kicks ass. So I want to look into their older stuff. Kick of Valentina. I don't know how you're not in these guys more.
I know. Because I literally listened to that song like last week for the first time. I'm like, oh, yeah, I got to throw that on there.
I never heard of it until, of course, we did this. But, I mean, here's a band that they've been down, what, how many times? When was every year, right? Drawing a blank.
For a while. They've been there for a while. I mean, been there and they've a while. Got a... I don't know about a bunch of albums, but they have.
But there was they're at M3 a few times.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. Maybe they come out too early.
They're too early. They do. We're like in the parking lot when they come out usually. So
we're having our kegs and eggs at that time.
Kegs and eggs, yeah. We have to check that more of that out. Of course, Godsmack. There's the verse. War and Peace. Sully ranks up there at my vocalists that no matter what they do, I'd be a fan of. Fight War of Words. I mean, what more can be said about this classic album when this came out? It was like, we're like, damn, Scott Travis, how can you go around there? And because a son of fucking like aggression and anger, it was great. And here's one of Reddy's I'm not really familiar with. It'd be the Sabaton with the, but I gotta look into this a little bit more. I mean, they're very.
I love it. I fucking love it.
It was very like, whoa. I think BB said it's just like very. How many people are singing in this? It's very catchy. I mean,
and they actually, they have two versions of that album. It's on Apple Music. There's the, like the regular album. But then there's the history version. There's like an audio file, like an audio part before each song that explains about what every song's about. It's something you can't listen. Like, I recommend listening to that version like once and then just listen to the album. But it's cool because it tells literally, because everything that's on that album is an actual thing from World War One. Very cool, though.
No, but that was my surprise out of list.
All right. You might as well go with your list, BC. Your last. I meant to flip flop me and you, but or you and BB. But go ahead.
We're gonna talk about war. My list starts off with my boys Megadeth. The spell check on my theme. Megadeth.
Megadeth.
With Holy Wars. I mean, one of my favorite albums of all time. Desert Island album. I had to pick something off this one. That's another Holy Wars. And then another band that I like. I'm kind of maybe a hits guy on these guys, but I like this song. This album's pretty good when you really sit down and listen to Slayer with the War Ensemble.
They would be happy to hear that they have hits, BC.
True.
Well, hits does.
More well-known songs.
Yeah, the well-known songs. Yeah. Not necessarily hits, but what our definition of hits would be.
War Ensemble.
I don't know. Every time I say I'm gonna get, and I get it, and then like something pushes me with him.
I think for Slayer, for me, I like I'll hear a song like, wow, that was cool, but I get burned out quickly on them.
Yeah, something about, I don't know, like, does it hold me? Yeah. When you hear it, or if you're out somewhere,
a lot of it sounds too alike for me.
Might be that, but when you're out at a show and it comes over to PA, you're just like, you just want to start like pushing people around.
It's a little bit different than sitting there with your headphones on.
Yeah,
because that's more here. That's more of a moment thing.
Yeah,
you know what I mean. You're in the moment there. Oh, you're not really in the moment at your house.
Then I'm gonna go to very underrated album. I think is a Rat with Tug of War off their 1999 self-titled album. I think, I mean, who was on it? Robbie Crane.
There were four piece for that.
Was that when we saw him at Tinks?
Mm-hmm.
That was a great show, and we discovered another.
I think that John Corabi played rhythm when we saw them for that tour, but it's just the four of them on the album.
You're right.
It was Robbie Crane on bass, John Corabi played rhythm guitar, and it was Warren DeMartini playing lead, and Steven and Bobby Blotzer. And
that was in Hair of the Dog opening up.
Mm-hmm.
Kept discovering another great band. Then I had to throw my boys in there. My next song with Dogs of War from Saxon. How can you not go bad with this band? I make they're supposed to be coming out with
the covers album.
But then they said they still have material for
good.
So hopefully maybe it'd be like two albums in 1 year.
We'll take it.
Be like 70s Kiss.
Yeah.
And then I'm gonna finish off my wars with the boys in Lone Axe after Love and War album with All's Fair and Love and War. Starts off with the little hair, dark as the dead of night, with the bass and drum tone. She flashed her eyes. Wow. And I love that. Wow. I don't think you can still do it nowadays, but I mean, love these guys from back in the day. That's my war songs. And believe it or not, the war songs are harder to come up with than the love songs, believe it or not.
Yeah, right.
You figured it'd be the other way around.
I know it.
Yeah.
All right, I'll go with BC's first off here. Holy Wars, Punishment Due from Rust in Peace. Fantastic song. And that's one of them things, like, you really can't say much more about that. If you're a Megadeth fan, that's one of your, you know, you're going to go to a show and you're not going to not
if you know that song.
Yeah, for sure. War Ensemble. First time I've ever heard this, I bought the, and I wish I still had this fucking CD, they put out that Decades Live or something like that. It was like from the Warfield, and I think it's San Francisco they recorded it. It was like fucking fan. And I just still remember War Ensemble. Like, and it gets into it. I like it, though. It's a good song. Like, I could take them in short bursts. Rat Tug of War, BC, you know that's, I feel the same way you do. A very underrated, kind of forgotten about Rat album. It has my favorite Rat song of all time on there, Lovesick. But Tug of War is great. It's got a little slow start to it, but when you get into the chorus, love is a rock of war. The chorus is really, really catchy. And I think that a lot of people missed out on that album. So if you can find it, check it out. It's still very good. I'm sure it's on Apple Music. Dogs of War, Saxon. I was thinking about this song today. I kind of lost track of Saxon probably after, I think, Rock the Nation, I think. I think I kind of got off of them for a little bit because they put out, like, Destiny and Dogs of War and Solid Ball Rock, those that cluster of albums. But then I picked up The Eagle Has Landed 2. It came out on CD. I picked that up, and it was, the first one is just a single CD, but this one was, like, a two CD, and it had a lot more songs on it. And Dogs of War was one of the songs. I'm like, this was the song that made me get those other Saxon albums. Sorry, Sonny Poonie, you guys. Fuck off. Saxon fucking is awesome. Just a great song. It's got that kind of, it's got that war feel to it. That just like, this is how the battle's going. It's got that intensity sound to it. All's Fair in Love and War, Lillian X. We got to see them do that live last year at the pre-party Monsters of Rock when we got to see Lillian X. Another band we never thought we would get to see ever. Great version of it, cool song. The background vocals are fantastic in it. Impressive, sir.
Yeah, I mean, Holy Wars, it's Megadeth. Yeah,
give it the
it's Megadeth. It's Megadeth. Fantastic song. Plus the second part of it's about the Punisher, so that's pretty cool. The Punishment Due. War Ensemble, I do like that song. Slayer is a band I need to delve deeper on, for sure. Tug of War, yeah, it did start off slow, but then I really enjoyed that when it actually got somewhere. I was like, oh my god, is this a ballad on the war part of the but then it picked up.
The chorus is fantastic.
Yeah, the chorus is really good. Saxon, it's interesting because it didn't feel very Saxon to me as a song. I don't know why. It was lacking that, you know, I don't know if it was just, it just hit me weird.
The production's not the best.
Yeah,
on
that's
that, one.
That I think that's what took it away from me, because it had like the elements of a Saxon song, but it lacked that, the backing.
Well, because now you're used to the production of their albums now.
Yeah, like I compared
the last
to,
couple were like, holy, well,
yeah.
I should put down like
I'm gonna give you
the live version.
Andy yeah. Sneap is their producer now, so anything before that is gonna sound lacking.
Yeah, and All's Fair in Love and War is a pretty good song. Plus, it's the title track of the playlist. So,
ta-da!
See that? You made the papers, BC.
There you go. Holy Wars for Megadeth, of course. We already said it. Great song, iconic song. Fantastic guitar work in that. So fast. So crazy ripping song. War Ensemble by Slayer. Like you guys, I kind of like teeter with Slayer. It was all right. It's a little bit heavy in my headphones. Tug of War by Rat. Love, love, love this song. Love how it starts like an acoustic guitar section right before the solo. Seaman's vocals are fantastic at this time of his career. The band sounds really, really good. What's that?
I almost didn't recognize him.
I know. It sounds that good, right? I thought he sounds amazing on this album.
You're not used to him singing in that register.
Yeah. Right. And that's what throws everybody off, right? But the band sounds really, really good at the chorus. Fantastic background vocals with this band. Saxon, Dogs of War. Their battle cry song, great drum work. Guitar work is fantastic. I never heard that song before. And Saxon's, I may be more like of a, like a hit Saxon guy. And I didn't know that song. All's Fair in Love and War, Lillian X. The only thing I didn't like about this, it took a little bit to get going, but once it gets going, it's so good. The squeals on the guitar are fantastic. The solo's great. Love the vocals. Very good list, sir, except for Slayer. Slayer's a little rough on my ears.
It's a hard pill to swallow. Hard pill to swallow.
All right, before we do the gym song, we were supposed to do this before, but I forgot. I'm not having a great night here.
What, are we going to skip me a fucking get? What, are my war songs that fucking bad?
He hasn't gone yet.
For the love of God.
I wrote them down wrong.
Oh my god!
Now didn't I just say I'm not having a good night?
That's it.
We're ready. You know
that's I wrote it. We're down gonna wrong. Start right over. We're starting over. That's
because it. I did the bottom part before I did the top part. So all right.
I didn't want to say anything. I got my list ready. He's like, all right, BC, you go.
All right, you're all right.
All right, go ahead.
Jesus Christ.
All right, BB, let's hear yours.
I don't know if I want to say it now.
All right, well, fuck you. I'm very offended. Get the whiskey out.
We're going to go to war.
We're going to war, damn it. Speaking of war.
Speaking of war.
Well, what he wanted to do, he wanted to drink before your...
Yeah, do you want to drink now? And then we'll talk about war?
I need to brace myself for these songs.
Okay. You better get a shot then.
Go ahead, BB.
Somebody give me a shot.
There's a lot of...
There's a little theme on this one, by the way.
There could have been... I told Dylan on the way down, there could have been one more, but I didn't want to overdo it.
Don't give me a shot.
Damn.
Not feeling a shot.
Come on.
Are we doing the shot now? Or?
No. We'll do his.
Okay. Okay.
Go ahead.
All right. My war songs. The first song I picked was Devil's Daughter, Holy War from Mr. Ozzy Osbourne on the No Rest for the Wicked album, released 1988. I love this tune. Love all these songs on this album. Great chugging guitar work throughout. I won't say who it is, but but the big drum sound from Randy Castillo is amazing. Little crying baby in there. I don't know if that's BC. I don't know if Judy sending a little sound clip of BC crying in the crib. That may be you there and there. But it definitely reminds me of like an old, like even like maybe like Blizzard of Oz Ozzy. It has that older Ozzy feel to this song. Song number two, Evil War from the band Fatal Smile off of their World Domination released 2008. These guys are a Swedish hard rock band formed in 1995. They were pretty popular back in the day. They actually opened up for Wasp and Winger. I kind of found this through like a rabbit hole through the Frontier Records guys, you know, the bands that they put out. Oh, if you like this, you like this, blah, blah, blah. The album is actually mixed by Michael Wagner. So, you know, if you got Michael Wagner in your back pocket, you know, you got to be pretty good. It's soft and dirty, raspy, like echoing vocals. It's really, really cool. It really grabbed my ear. The guitar work, fantastic. Drum work is even better in this song. Song number three, War Cry from Wasp from the Headless Children album, 1998, I believe it's released. Another triple great threat with Blackie, Chris Holmes, and Frankie Minnelli. Blackie's vocals are spot on, actually amazing in this song. It goes from soft to screaming at a drop of a hat, but definitely the drums are what actually make the song. Frankie Benelli really, really beats the skins on this. Love it. Song number four, War Pigs, live from Zach Sabbath. Off the Zach Sabbath Live in Detroit EP album from 2016. He's got Blasco on bass, who was with Ozzy and Rob Zombie. And on drums, he's got Joey Castillo from Danzig and Queens of the Stone Age. Great version live. The crowd's into it. Crowd singing, clapping at the chorus. Zach extends it to a little bit borderline too long with his guitar work. But the band sounds amazing on this. That's why I kind of wanted to put this on there. Almost like you wanted to say the Saxon live. Zach Sabbath live. Really, really good stuff. And close out my list. From 1994, Pride and Glory's off their self-titled only album, Horse Called War. The three guys in this, Brian Tishy's on drums, James Lomenzo's on the bass on this. There's only three of them, and Zach's guitar and vocals, of course. Got that heavy, great southern rock sound to them. Fantastic album. It's one of those albums that they're almost like the heavier Lynyrd Skynyrd of 1994. Great guitar work as usual. Zach's vocals are actually nice and soft compared to what he releases now. It's a little bit easier on the ears. And even there's a little spot in the right at the solo when he does that. He turns it off and on the guitar like really, really fast. It's really, really cool. So, and like I said, I could have, like I told Dylan, actually War of Heaven from BLS on the Order of Black album I could have used. But I'm sure your Zach ears were bleeding enough three out of the five songs. So, BC, what'd you think?
How can you go wrong with Ozzy, with Devil's Daughter? I love that whole album. Another Not underrated album. Just
yeah, it's a weird. It's a weird.
When it came to everything, was about Zach. Yeah. Zach. That you didn't hear too much about.
But there's some good fucking songs on that album.
There is. I don't know why I did.
It's got my favorite Ozzy song on there.
Fatal Smile. I never heard of this until now.
Yeah.
And I was like, that's different.
Not bad.
No, not bad at all. Dude, are they around or was that?
They're from. I don't know. They're a Swedish band. I don't know. I think their last album is. I'll check.
Okay.
Their last album was 2018.
So there's a good chance they're still around.
Next, Wasp War Cry. You know what I think about this album. I wish. Not against Steve Riley, but can you imagine if
Frankie stayed with them?
Not only that, but if he was on the two albums before that. I don't know.
Kind of like how you think about it if Scott Travis was on the couple of Priest albums before.
Yeah, like, would the songs be even that much? You know what I mean?
Even just the drum sound.
Yes.
The drum that sound. Much.
2014 BC. Sorry.
Oh, so they may be defunct. Mm.
The 1, 2, 3, it's still four, good though, five, six. They got six albums up.
And the next one, Zach Sabbath. It's live music. How can you go around with, especially a great song like War Pigs live in a band like that? And your final song there, Pride and Glory, A Horse Called War. I mean, believe it or not, I'm not really too familiar with that album. So that's,
I don't know.
That's my guilty.
I don't know. We can't be friends, BC.
I know.
I'm gonna buy that for your birthday on vinyl, and you're gonna listen to it. God damn.
Over and over
and over and over and over again.
Over. But no, good list. I think good.
Dylan, what'd you think?
Well, I had only heard technically two of the songs, but I did not hear one version of. One of the songs. I had never heard Devil's Daughter. That was an Aussie album that I've never really checked out. And you called it an ear pull, you know, an ear catcher. I'm going to dub those Carol Burnett's. Said she used to do the tugging of the ear. So I'm going to say that was a Carol Burnett song for me. It was a really good, really catchy thing. And the guitarist on it was fantastic. I wonder who it was. Fatal Smile, another really, this just like BC, I didn't know who they were, and I was surprised by how much I like the song. Wasp, I've heard, you know, it's Wasp. Like I said, I'm not a big fan of Blackie's vocals, but the guitar work on it is great, and the music's fantastic. This version of War Pigs, I really enjoyed. It's very, very cool to hear this band. I like Blasco, so. I'm always happy to hear him playing bass. And then Horse Called War, I think, was probably my biggest Carol Burnett on this list. I thought it was going to be acoustic. I don't know why I thought Pride and Glory was all acoustic.
Oh.
But this was really good. I was very captivated by it. What do you think, Deb?
All right. So we got two unbearded and one bearded Zach.
Yes.
Okay.
Three-fifths of the
list. Three-fifths. Okay. You could have went for a fucking sweep, because you could have did that other song you said,
right?
And then you could have did Black Rain. Oh, that's not war.
No. What?
No.
Guys,
the fuck you are, but what did you do with Steve?
I don't know. I'm gonna need that shot sooner than later. Jeez. Okay. I'm sure there's another song somewhere. In there somewhere. Yeah. You could have definitely. When I saw the first two, I'm like, he's gonna do a fucking Zach fucking sweep.
He's gonna sweep it.
Where are we at? Devil's Daughter, excellent song, I really good. And I'm a BC. I really like that. No Rest for the Wicked album. It's fantastic. Randy Castillo's drums are fucking fantastic on there. Evil War. I never heard that either. I thought it was good, and it was, and it has that sound that
grabs your ear.
That grabs your ear. That type of, not quite Eclipse or Heat, but it has that kind of.
Frontier,
a little bit of a
Swedish
feel to it.
Rock sound that they all have now, right?
They, War Cry from Wasp. That's actually a bonus track that was released on the CD when they re-released it. And I think it fits in good with the rest of the album. So that could have definitely been an album track on Headless Children. Very cool. Frankie Benelli, just the drums are fucking insane on that whole album. That song is no exception. A Horse Called War. And I was like, Dylan, because I'm thinking,
God damn it.
He fucking got me again with some shit ass fucking acoustic shit. And but then I'm thinking, no, I heard this song before.
That's good.
This song, it has sick bananas bass and drums during the solo. I was like, holy fuck. I was blown away. I'm like, who the fuck played on it? I knew Brian Tichy played on it, but I wasn't sure if it was Lomenzo or if it was Blasco on bass on this album. Because it came out in the 90s, right?
94,
right?
Yeah.
So I'm like, I did hear the song before. But, like, I never really – I think I maybe heard the album all the way through maybe once. And I've heard House – I keep on saying House. Horse Called War. I've heard that maybe 10 times, maybe, like, you know, if it comes on – Boneyard or something like that, or playing here or there, and I forgot it's a good song, but like I said, the sick bananas bass and drums on that song just fucking, and I was like, holy shit. And actually that was one of the only songs on this list that I listened to, and then I really hit rewind and I played it like twice in a row.
Wow.
Because I was like, wow, sick bananas, wow. Drums and bass. I mean, typical, yes. Zach guitar, you know, pinch harmonic up the ass, but good though. And I do like his more of understated vocals on that song, where it's not
the whiny.
It gets like every song is like the exact same vocals on it. You know what I mean? It's different. War Pigs from Zach Sabbath. I was like, holy fuck!
Imagine being in Detroit listening to that song.
The only thing I wish is because it's not on any of the streaming things, but like we like watch the video and listen to the song. I wish that the actual video went with the song, because it was all dubbed here and there, different things, and you could tell it wasn't different. The actual whole song that they filmed. But like I like it. I'll tell you what, it may be my second favorite version of War Pigs. The first one being from Tesla. Speak of the Devil. No. With Brad Gillis playing.
I thought you were going to say Tesla.
No.
It's not that bad of a version?
No, it's not, but it doesn't make my top five versions.
Reel to reel?
I would love if they actually put out a whole concert, because that EP, it has that song, it has Fairies Wear Boots, and it has Super Not. That's the only three songs on the whole.
Really?
I would hear Zach play Electric Funeral and hear him do the electric funeral.
Yeah, I like a good list. Like I said, like Fatal Smile, that's the only one I hadn't heard before.
Yeah, that's...
War Cry, I may have heard it once or twice, but like that absolutely could have fit perfect on that Headless Children album. Well done, sir.
Thank you, sir. I have good teachers.
All right, now we did everybody, right?
Yep.
Phew! Did everybody. And what note were you passing over there? What did you write down?
No, BC asked, he said, what was the video that was released from that album? I think it's Machine Gun Man.
They're all playing there.
Yeah, the three of them are on like a log raft, and they're going down like the Mississippi or something. Do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do. And they're like playing like, Zach's almost like playing like a banjo at some point. I want to say it's Machine Gun Man.
I thought he said Righty on that. I thought I saw Righty on that paper. I'm just saying.
We'll continue. We'll figure
that's
it out.
That's underneath it.
Okay, you're right. All right. Righty. See, you know, it starts with the M. I read it upside down, so Righty. That looked like a W to me.
Righty is crazy.
who the fuck is this guy?
You're so conceited, Claire.
Are you talking about me? Okay. All right, so there's our war songs, and I hope you guys enjoy them. They're going to be on our Spotify playlist that Dylan's going to so graciously put in the show notes at the end of the show. And
I already made it, too.
Yeah, because actually that's ta-da! What we use for the episode. I like when we do that, so let's keep doing that.
You can make out a playlist one of these times.
I can make a playlist in 8 seconds on Apple Music. Doing one on fucking Spotify takes me fucking as long as it takes to listen to the songs. I'm terrible at Spotify. Horrible. Because it's not really what I use.
Practice, practice, practice.
The only time I really use it is when you or Sonny make a playlist for an episode.
That's how you get to Carnegie Hall.
I'm more comfortable with Apple Music.
Okay.
But Spotify does have stuff because we're doing an episode on another band next week, and the album, one of the albums we're doing was only available on Spotify, wasn't available on Apple Music. So before we move on, I'm gonna turn the microphone over to BC doing
shots.
Black in his ear.
shot me.
Right now,
it's not cold gin.
It's not cold gin, but we have the, it's not new, but the Metallica whiskey. The Metallica whiskey blackened. I'm going to try to pop it without spilling it over the table.
And the cool thing about these whiskeys are that each of them has a number, and the number corresponds to a playlist that each of the band members made. And this bottle was 101, and the playlist was selected and arranged by Robert Trujillo. The songs on this bottle's playlist are Phantom Lord, Wherever I May Roam, The End of the Line, To Live is to Die, Overkill, Last Caress / Green Hell, Whiplash, and Nothing Else Matters.
I put yours to the side. I can't drink it if Nothing Else Matters is played. This is going to suck then.
Well, I mean, even like To Live is to Die, that's an instrumental at the end of the...
That's all right, though, but it's not shitty. Like, Nothing Else Matters. Terrible.
Got two covers on the playlist.
But the bottle is very cool.
Yeah, let's see.
And
a blend of straight whiskeys finished in black brandy casks.
What do you go do now? Because like the guy they did this with passed away.
Oh really?
Oh yeah.
The guy that made it,
mixed it or whatever.
Oh really?
Whatever they do.
A bold collaboration of the finest hand selected whiskeys, an unrivaled composition of craft and creativity, born in cask, forged by sound, bottled by Sweet Amber Distilling Company, Mineville, New York.
Oh,
now they say they play this these songs while it's aging. Do we believe that?
I do. I don't think it's something they'd make. It's kind of cool.
Oh yeah, I mean,
I like that.
The bottle's cool looking, and it has a cork, so it's not like a screw cap either. Yeah. So it has an embedded cork in there.
It says "Blacken the World" on the other side.
Whoa. So with that cork in there, so do you have to store it like where the cork is wet? You know, like a wine bottle.
Just get the decanter.
But let's be honest. It's not going to last that long for the cork to fucking dry out.
Did you allow it to air it?
I'm going to say,
this is the second bottle of this because the first bottle got drank by people.
Not by me.
Not by me.
We were supposed to do this for my birthday episode. I'm like, did you bring the whiskey? He's like, it's gone. I'm like, what? They drank it on me. I'm like, you fucking kidding me? I said, if you get another bottle, make sure you don't uncork it until we taste test it on the episode.
Because it was before Christmas, and I said to my wife, I said, I'm going to order that bottle. It's like $52 a bottle. She said, you're not spending $52 on a bottle of whiskey. And I'm like, I spent way more than that. You know, I'm thinking, what? And for some reason.
Do you know how much I paid for Lizzie Borden album?
Yeah. You're worried about $52? So I was like, wondering the Christmas came, and open up, and go, man, now I know why.
That's why.
Uh-huh. And like, it was gone like 2 days.
Yeah, I'm like, dude, I'm like, you're bringing the whiskey. He's like, it's gone. I'm like, fuck. Come on.
So we had to get in our bottle.
All right, so let's taste this.
All right.
Cheers.
Cheers, boys.
Blackened.
Ooh, let's chase it.
Rough.
No, it's pretty smooth.
Yeah, it's not bad.
It's pretty smooth. It's got a little smokage taste to it, maybe. Like a little smoky.
Yeah. A little smoke and a little right in the end. A good little punch.
It does. It's got a little kick at the end there. It's good. It's good. It's something to be nice. Throw in a glass with some ice. Have you tried it with like a Coke or Pepsi or anything? Or just you're just drinking out of the bottle. Just be truthful.
This is the first time you actually tried it, right?
This is the first time I had it without
anything.
He's usually drinking it with a paper bag around it. out on the sidewalk on the park bench across the street. It was good though. So try it, guys. It's blackened, as BC said, $52 a bottle. I would personally pick a bottle that they didn't play Nothing Else Matters on. I would pick a different playlist bottle, but it was good. Yeah. I enjoyed it. And it's got a
black brandy cast.
It's clear my sinuses though. I like it.
You can definitely feel that brandy in the back end. Definitely.
Yep. All right, so now let's play our gym song this week, and I'm going to stick with the theme, and I talked about these guys and who I'm listening to. House of Lords got kind of on a little kick of their albums in the 2000s, really good stuff out there. So we're going to play Even Love Can't Save Us from the 2008 Come to My Kingdom album. So Dylan's going to play that, and we're going to drink the rest of this fucking whiskey.
Yeah.
Even love can't save us.
Right, we are back. Hope you guys enjoyed Even Love Can't Save Us from House of Lords from the 2008 Come to My Kingdom album. If you guys have not checked out the House of Lords, like their whole catalog, really, there's a ton of great stuff on there. And the and even for like even their like late 90s stuff, early 2000s, the production is fantastic on there. Jimmy Bell, their current guitar player, is as the guitar player on the song you guys just heard, Come to My Kingdom. And I was looking at that album on Apple Music, or not Apple Music, online, and in the writing credits, like, Jimmy Bell, like, wrote most of that album, and it's really, really good, so check that out. Cool guy, BC, we got to meet him on the Monsters Rock Cruise, got a picture in the hallway with him and Simon Daniels from Autograph, because he's in Autograph as well as House of Lords, just a really super nice guy. And so give them a chance. Check them out. And they had actually had an album out last year, New World, New Eyes, I believe it's called. And so let's do our hidden gems now. And BC, I know you have one ready, so we're going to let you go first because it's unusual that, like, BC walks in the room. I had to remind him three times what it was, but he does have one.
I remember having it.
This has been fermenting in the gym vat for weeks.
Okay, I just surfing through shit this week and came across a follow Saxon, different sites for Saxon, and this is like a little side project Biff has been doing for months. But it's Biff, Eric Peterson from Testament, J.J. French from Twisted Sister, and help me out with the last two guys. The girl's name, Cecilia
Napo from Black Mamba, and then Hans von Dahl from Sabaton.
I wonder if
it's related to Chris Van Dahl from L.A. Guns.
But I was like, whoa, what the hell is this? I clicked on, they had a video on it, and of course it's the social distancing where they all do their parts from their homes, I guess you would say. It's good. I like it. It immediately caught my ear. I don't know. You heard it, right?
Yeah, I heard it. I thought it was really good. It was because BC's like, hey, check this out. And I'm like, because usually it's me like, hey, yeah, check this out. So BC, when he gives me something to check out, I liked it. I think it's really good. And
it doesn't really say if it's an album or not.
I think it does, because I think if you look on Apple Music, it says from upcoming album, I think. But, like, you don't hear Eric Peterson a lot from Testament, because, I mean, he's there with Alex Skolnick. I mean, like,
he's in
the fuck, you might as well be another, you know, like a second guitar player in fucking, like, Van Halen or something like that. But he's fucking excellent, too. Like, if you listen to their last, album he's been on.
Very underrated guy.
They both play a lot of kick-ass shit, but just Alex is the guy that's more out front, but Eric Peterson is fucking fantastic.
And I think the not the surprise or the oddball, I think it's J.J. French.
When you said that, I'm like, J.J. French? Yeah. Like, I haven't heard him, his name, no, anything new that's forever.
That's a name I haven't heard in quite a long time.
Yeah, that, and I mean, the drummer's really good. I mean, the girl kicks ass on bass. I never heard of her.
No, I didn't
Black something or whatever.
Black Mamba.
Black Mamba.
That was Uma Thurman's code name.
Uma Thurman in
Kill Bill.
Kill Bill, yeah.
So I know Steve heard it. Did you hear it?
I did not hear it.
Okay.
Oh,
check it out.
Yes, I'll check it out.
I'll go home and listen to it.
Maybe Dylan can add it to the playlist.
Maybe.
Just maybe.
Maybe not.
That means probably not, so look it up yourselves. Yeah. All right, BB, what do you got?
Dylan's going to say I couldn't find that on Spotify. let's go back to 1995. How about Rocks Gang? Love the Rocks Gang with the song Hot for Love off the Voodoo You Love album. Great song. Just that sleazy, grindy sound that the Rocks Gang have. And like you said before, like there's so many... It was kind of hard to find like war songs. Like I found like 8,000 love songs.
Oh, love songs are out.
Like love songs are out the wazoo. So
and
this
I was like,
is
that's weird.
This was like kind of threw a dart at like the 60 I had, and this is what I landed on. But Rocks Gang, fantastic band, very underrated. Check these guys out.
That's a kick.
Definitely.
Dylan,
my hidden gem is a band I just checked out today. I think they're relatively new. I don't think they have many. Oh no, I mean they have an album from back in 2016, but. A band called Painted Wives, and the album's called New Medusa. Really cool metal album. The vocalists I really enjoy. They have a really nice quality to their voice. It's a cool album cover. Painted Wives with New Medusa.
I think he said
the album. I think New Medusa is a better band name than Painted Wives, but who am I to judge? My band name was really stupid.
Well, it's tough to talk about a painted wife when you don't have one. All right, so my turn. Mine's got a little bit of story. Last Saturday from when we recorded, this was my birthday. So BB and I were supposed to go to this vinyl store in about an hour away from where we live. And BB wasn't able to make it. So I'm like, you know what? Fuck it. I went by myself on my birthday, which was totally fine. My wife offered to go. I said, you know what? I said, it was cool. I had a nice ride.
No offense.
All by yourself.
No offense. Crank the tunes. I didn't have to be in a conversation the whole way down, the whole way back. And then, like, if my wife goes with me, like I said, no offense, she'd be in the car, and I would feel that I was rushed in there, have to, you know. So I just had a nice leisurely time, looked through. I was able to find Jugulator and Demolition from Judas Priest. I picked up Demolition for BC, Jugulator for myself. I picked up some Saxon picture discs for myself in BC. They had two for a good price. And years ago, and I've talked about the song before, song Rockin' from Pat Travers. And I always wondered what album this came from or if it was a cover song. And I always wondered, but I guess I was just too fucking lazy to actually look it up, which I should have because it's actually on Apple Music, but I didn't. So I'm going through the albums and the used section, and there's a bunch of Pat Travers ones, ones that I've seen, ones that I have, and I see this one is called Pat Travers, like with the apostrophe at the top, so it's like Pat Travers Black Pearl, so like the Black Pearl was his band, so it was like Pat Travers and Black Pearl. So I'm like, oh, I never seen this before, so I flip it over, and I'm like, holy shit, there's the fucking song Rockin', last song on the album. So it was $5. I pick it up. I go home, and I'm like, holy shit, I'm excited. I bought like probably 6 or 7 albums, and like I'm like, this is the one I got to put on first. I said, but I'm going to listen to the whole album for it because it's the last song on the album. So I'm like, I put the album on. Starts with, and actually I was going to pick this song too. It's called La La Love You from Pat Travers, one of his more well-known songs. Really, really good. So I listen to the whole album, and I'm like, this album is fucking fantastic. And then the song Rockin' comes on, and it is fantastic, even fucking excellent on the album version. So I'm just going to do the whole Black Pearl album from Pat Travers, 1982. Really great, just hard rock. There's a little bit of bluesy stuff on there. There's a little bit of some keyboardy stuff on there. But it's good, though. It all fits together really cool. So there's our gems. Dylan's got... New Medusa, New Wives.
Painted Wives.
Painted Wives.
Painting you, BC.
Painted Wives.
I'm like Bob Ross.
New Medusa.
Gonna put making a, little
we're
trees.
Gonna put, we're going to put a little BC on the end of the lake here. So that's Dylan's. We got Rocks Gang Hot for Love from the Voodoo You Love 1995 from BC, or BB. We got Spin the Wheel with Biff Byford, J.J. French, and Eric Peterson, and the the chick on bass and the dude on drums.
Spin the Wheels, the song.
Spin the Wheels is the song.
Metal Reels
is the band.
And, spin the wheel, make the deal.
Pat Travers's Black Pearl, 1982, the album. And the key song on that is Rockin'. It's fucking fantastic. So now, let's get into our love song. Because we want to end. We talked about war, destruction,
war,
hatred, all that shit.
How come nobody picked love song?
Because it sucks. My opinion.
That's next year.
But that was talked about to death, though. I think someone picked that on the ballads one, which was even a bad pick for a ballad fucking episode.
It's played to death.
I think Jen picked it. Jen or BB picked it. Since I fucked up the order before, I'm going to flip this order. So, BB, since I boned you on that one, you're going to go first for love songs.
You got this.
Oh, thanks, buddy. I love you, buddy.
I love you.
Oh, man. I feel honored. All right. So, my love songs. Whew. Oh, fuck, I don't have any fucking Zach Wilde. What the fuck? How the fuck did I fuck this up?
Well, I'm sure there's something you could have found.
I could have. I definitely could have. But, hell, let's go back. Let's go back to Ted Nugent's Love Grenade. That loincloth wearing Detroit rock Cupid arrow shooting motherfucker Uncle Ted. Gotta love Love Grenade.
That was BC, by the way.
Come on.
Little fucking
come on.
BC.
We're talking about love now.
I guess we have to say something, man.
You should be all up on love. You just got married.
We're talking about love. We're talking about Uncle Ted.
I was at BC's house the other day. The fucking honeymoon's over, okay?
Oh,
he's
man,
got a fucking cap stroller and everything in the house.
You could have picked a Love Unreal from Grimmest Hits.
That's right. That's
actually a good
song. That is a good song. I really could have overloaded you, but... Nah. Let's go Uncle Ted. But he gets his buddy Jack Blades to play the bass on this one. This song is just fucking so good. It has that great sound with his big Gibson Birdland guitar. It's fucking Uncle Ted, BC. The great riffs, slide guitar parts. And it has that little sleazy lyrics that Uncle Ted knows how to, like, throw in there. But, fantastic song off the Love Grenade album. That's deep in his catalog. I think it's like his 13th album, but a great album front to back. Song number two, Rain of Love from Hurricane, 1990, off their Slave to the Thrill album. Doug Aldridge, BC, how can we not have an episode where we don't talk about Doug Aldridge? Here you go. He's on this, squealing and scrapes on this guitar. Fucking fantastic. Kelly Hansen's vocals, so fucking big and powerful. Love it, love his vocals. Little synth underlay in that solo is fantastic. Great, great song, Rain of Love from Hurricane. Song number three, Don't Blame It on Love from Danger Danger off their Screwed album, 1991. I think I've actually... said this before that it may have been like a gem song or we talked about this, but the one night I was actually at the kitchen table, I was kind of like doing a little bit of this, and my daughter walked by, who is the big music person of the family, and she's like, oh, what are you doing? And we're like, oh, I kind of told her what the episode was about, and she's like, oh, don't forget that Danger Danger song, Don't Blame It on Love. I'm like, all right, I'm putting it down. So Casey, great pick. Happy Valentine's Day to you, honey.
Love her.
Gotta throw her props. The only one to actually walk around the house with headphones, listen to music. But Ted Poley's vocals are great. Great. 1991. He's got like the big hair vocals going on for him. Great, fantastic hair rock from 1991. Danger Danger, definitely out there in the forefront of the bands back in the 90s. Song number four, Midnight Love by Fifth Angel. You guys may not know this one. All the way back from 1998 off of their Time Will Tell album. These guys are from Bellevue, Washington. They were formed in 1983. Such a great melodic sound. They have great harmonies. Awesome guitar work. Heavy melodic sound to these guys. They almost remind me of like Denman in a way. They have that Denman sound to me kind of a little bit, but a great song. If you guys have not heard these guys, Fifth Angel, definitely check these guys out. Fantastic, fantastic band. And of course, I'm going to close out my love list with Gimme Love from Devil's Train, from the Devil Train 2 album from 2015. Ever since that day going to Nashville, Devil's Train has been in my ear forever. Thank you, Wrighty. These guys starts out with like this heavy jazz rock riff opening. Vocals are fucking fantastic. Guitar work's even better than the vocals. And I said the guitar work on this song is sick bananas, B. Wrighty.
It could be.
But there's my list. So hopefully, I didn't put any Zach in there for you, BC, because I know you're getting Zacked out. So what'd you think?
I don't get Zacked out now. Ted Nugent with the Love Grenade. Great song, great album. That was. I remember when I came out, we put it on. I think me and you picked it up and mm-hmm. threw it on the old CD player in the car, and it was like, oh yeah. That was like kick-ass album. Your second pick, Hurricane, Rain of Love. I've been on Hurricane kick since I saw him open up for Striper back in, God knows what album that was.
84? Probably 80.
Oof. It was when they had their first album. So it was 85?
84.
Might have been 86. 85. When did the...
Hell with the Devil came out in 86, I think. So probably 84, 85.
No, they opened it. It was to Hell with
the Devil. So it would have been 80, probably 86, early 87.
Then Scranton there at the CYC.
Where they canceled Ozzy.
Bastards.
Where Muhammad Ali fought, I think, right? Hmm? Didn't Muhammad Ali fight there?
He may have back in the day.
Back in the day, yeah.
I think it was back when he still Cassius Clay.
Yeah, because he trained like in mm-hmm. the Poconos.
Yeah.
Danger, Danger with Don't Believe in On Love. I mean, to me, they're two great albums. And even after that, a lot of people don't know they have other albums after yep. that, unfortunately. And the one album is pretty cool. They put it out with Ted on vocals and Paul Lane on vocals. I'm drawing a blank on the album name, so please forgive me on that. But if you look it up, there's two versions of it. Same album, same songs. Ted does the vocals on one version. Paul Lane is doing the vocals really? Wow. on the other.
That is, see, I didn't know that.
You don't know
that? No.
Wow. I like Paul Lane, don't get me wrong. He's a good
vocalist. So it's after Screwed then?
Yeah, it's after the first two. It's even after the one that came out after that even. I'm drawing a blank on it.
So then it's after the live one that we did.
Yeah.
Okay.
Because I want to say.
Because then Paul Lane did all those solo albums after that, too.
He did a bunch of albums.
Yeah.
But it's pretty cool. I think it's pretty cool because you see both vocalists doing it.
Right.
And they're both good. I mean, they're both different in their own ways. But Fifth Angel, BB. I've been a Fifth Angel guy since the beginning. Steve knows that. Midnight Love, great song. Great albums, and they just came out with the new one 2018.
Yeah.
Their latest was in 2018. And I've been watching them on YouTube.
Yeah.
The same thing that Lizzie Borden played. I forget what festival it is over there. There's so many of them, you lose track.
Yeah.
Over there, meaning not the United States.
Yeah.
And we get M3.
This is probably one of the newer ones that I'm really digging is The Devil's Train, Gimme Love. I mean, it's... Good album. Love the vocals on it. But that's definitely a new band I needed to delve into a little bit more.
And don't feel bad. There's only two albums, so you'll burn right through it.
Catch up quick.
But no. Love your list. That's good.
That's my love list.
That's why I love it.
Love it.
Okay,
love. Good. All right. Dylan.
Yeah. I mean, Danger, Danger. Love that song. Don't Blame It on Love is just a classic 80s, you know, hair metal song for me.
And it has some woes in it.
Yeah, whoa. It does. I mean, Devil's Train, fantastic. Like, we sung the praises of this album. Oof. What was that for? Was that...
Which one?
The Devil's Train album. What was that episode we were talking about this album?
I know. It seems like I always bring them up, it seems.
Was it a birthday episode?
It might have been a birthday. I think it was birthday BB's episode. Birthday episode we did.
Yeah, because we were all blown away by it.
Yeah, I think it was.
Love Grenade. So I like this album because it has Geronimo and Me. It has Still Raising Hell. It's a pretty good song. This song, it sounds like he's trying to be Ace. I don't know
There's
why.
There's a different tone in his vocals.
Like,
yeah,
it sounds
easily,
like he's
yes.
pulling
why
at Ace.
Why would you want to sound like Ace?
That's what I'm saying. Oh, I don't like this song that much.
I don't think I've heard anybody sing it.
He sounds like Ace when he's singing.
Ted just
I don't
fucking sat bolt up in bed. What the Something just fucking what happened.
I mean, am I, like, does anybody else, can anybody else hear that? Like, that's...
No,
I know, there is a different sound that he...
He sounds different on this song. And it sounds very, the way he, like elongates some of the words is very ace-like.
I agree.
Thank you.
But he didn't say, grenade!
He wants a grenade!
No, he was more of a low-key ace, but yeah. No, these were good songs.
I'm going to listen to that and be like...
No, yeah, he definitely has a different tone to his voice in the song.
Thank you. I'm glad somebody agrees.
I know what you mean, but I know what you mean by difference, but I never thought ace.
Righty.
Okay. Let me make sure that I'm on the love songs and the right guy here. Okay.
We'll start with Love Grenade by Ted Nugent.
There we go. I'm going reverse. Give me Love Devil's Train. You know I got you hooked on those guys, which...
This is the best song of the night. I don't care what anybody says.
I'll tell you what, you guys, honestly, if you have not checked out Devil's Train, check them out. Devil's Train, self-titled.
Get on the
Devil's
Train.
Devil's Train 2, hop on the train. You will not be fucking sorry. If you like straightforward hard rock, check these guys out. Gimme Love is just fantastic, one of them kick-ass songs. Midnight Love from Fifth Angel. Good rocking song. I like the ripping solo on it. And then it gets melodic, like towards the. I like it. It's good. BC, like he said, he's been trying to get me hooked on Fifth Angel. That was when we first started hanging out and being friends and shit. Like that was one of the band. Like you know, we'd throw it. Okay, you know, you're trying to top your buddy. You know, I like you know, I'm trying to throw an obscure band. You know, Hurricane. It'd be like Fifth Angel. I'm like, ooh, that one I didn't know.
Don't know that one.
So that was one that he threw out there that I didn't know that I've checked out in the meantime. That really, really good. Where are we at here? Don't Blame It on Love, Danger, Danger. We talked about that because we did the live version. When that starts out, and I may even have said it on the when we did the live album, it sounds just like fucking Rick Springfield, Jesse's Girl. That dun 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 dun.
A little bit.
I'm like, holy shit, he's gonna fucking. And I was thinking it again, like they're gonna play Jesse's Girl. And I'm like, no, that's not the song. It's got the whoa whoas in it. I'm in.
You're in.
I'm down. Put me down. Mark me down. Rain of Love Hurricane, fun rocking song, great vocals. And I totally forgot until you brought it up that Doug Aldrich was the ripped it up on this album. Doug Aldrich. Fucking
flaming
fantastic.
The thrill, baby.
Really good. And that was one I'm like, ooh, Rain of Love. I'm like, I haven't heard, and that was a song I hadn't heard in a while. Really enjoyed listening to it.
Because Robert Zarzo was the guitar player.
Right.
And then all of a sudden, like, the third album came out, and you're like, this sounds different. Then when you looked at it, you're like, Doug Aldrich.
He has that stamp. It's
man,
that.
Oh man. He's all over the
I
place.
Don't know if it's that little tinge of bluesy, hard
slidey
rock stuff.
Rock.
He stands on the crowd. Yeah.
He does. Because like, even listen to the albums when he was in Dio. Listen to the albums when he recorded with Whitesnake. Right, you could parallel those albums, but then when he's gone, that sound is gone too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Not saying that it's good or bad in another way, but like once, like he is gone, there's like a different feel to the band, like with Doug. But I mean, just fantastic. Whatever he's in, that sprinkle he puts in the band is his own original stamp, and it's kick ass. But I totally forgot that was him on there. Mm-hmm. I mean. Dumb ass me. I should have been like, "Ooh, shit, that's Doug Aldrich on there." But
he's
I totally
turning,
forgot
he's
about
turning
it.
Into one
but
of
that
those
guys
are like my bucket.
That
list
was a little earlier Doug stuff.
Yeah,
you know what I mean. He wasn't as prolific and as recognizable then as he
is
now.
Right.
But like his stuff now is just absolutely kick ass. Last song, Love Grenade, and the funny thing about Love Grenade is I'm like, "Ooh, BB put Love Grenade on there." I remember when. I don't even think we're doing the podcast yet. We were just throwing albums back and forth, and BB called me or texted me, "Holy shit, I just listened to the Love Grenade album from Ted. It's fucking awesome." And BB was just gushing about this album, and it's fantastic. It's got cowbell in it, BB. It's got
a little
fucking
bit, a little cowbell
in it.
Boy.
Not a whole lot, but
a little bit.
But the solo in this song has a very classic Ted Nugent solo feel to it, like a solo that you may hear in like you know, Just What the Doctor Ordered or you know, Great White
you
Buffalo.
You can see him playing that big Gibson.
Yeah, it has that feel to it. Excellent. Just great. Well done, sir. Once again,
thank
well
you.
Done.
Thank you.
I fucking hate these episodes, and I can't bust his ass. I figured this, with love being one of the topics for the song list, I figured BB's going to hammer with like 5 acoustic songs here. But he didn't. And I appreciate that.
No problem. See?
Well done.
I'm taking care of you. There were actually a whole shit ton. We had War Machine from a Red Dragon Cartel.
And Kiss.
When I Find Love, XYZ. Sacrifice Your Love, Babylon AD. Love Kills from somebody we may talk about later. Gimme Your Love from Black and Blue. See, I can go on and on and on and on. I could have.
Love song wise, there's a ton of them.
It was hard to narrow it down.
Who needs to go next?
It's BC.
No.
Okay.
Come on, it was pretty simple. The Killer Bees were last, and then you and I were first.
I was so confused. God damn it.
We all talked about the songs.
I don't get them, so somebody needs to orchestrate.
Oh, I'm sorry. Aren't you the host of this podcast?
Yeah, what the hell?
I had to piss.
Okay.
Go ahead, BC. Okay,
more shots for everybody.
I'm dealing with other things going on. You just go. I'm letting go of the wheel.
He just gets up and leaves the car.
Go That's ahead. I'm excited to hear your songs. What do you got?
All right. You know, I'm always plugging this guy all the time, every chance I get. My first pick's going to be my boy Lizzie Borden with Love You to Pieces off the same album, Love You to Pieces. I mean, this is the second album, actually. It's the first Lizzie Borden album, but the second album I got off of Lizzie after Minister Society. I mean, to me, these first two Lizzie Borden albums are guitar work is phenomenal with them. And just off the scale, ripping songs. They go over live great. Anyways, I have to step back a few steps. I get crazy when I talk about Lizzie. And my second pick's going to be from Death Leopard with Pyromania, which was a classic album that I played to death in 1983 with Too Late for Love, which, I mean, how can you go wrong? Any song off that album was just totally a great album. To me, Death Leopard is firing all cylinders then. And then after that, we'll discuss that in a different episode. My third pick is going to be from my boys in Queensryche with the Alpha Operation Mindcrime with the I Don't Believe in Love.
Never have.
Never have. And never will. Never will. But, I mean, classic song, classic album. I don't think there's any of these albums I've named so far is not a classic album. Next pick's going to be my boys in a Typo Negative with the October Rust with Love You to Death. Love you to death. And Peter Steele, the vocals are so unique. That's another guy that, as soon as it comes on, Peter Steele. Typo Negative. No doubt in the world. And I'm going to finish up my list for love with the guys we finally got to see on the Monsters Rock Cruise this past year with Thunder with Love Walked In. I mean, for a slower tune, these guys fucking were phenomenal. They tore it up. We had to see them twice. They were one of the bands we saw twice. And I was totally blown away by how good they are live, how they sounded great. I mean, the vocals, he still has the kick-ass voice. But Love Walked In. What do you think, BB?
Van Halen?
No.
Thank God.
Whoa.
Thank God.
Thunder.
Oh, Lizzie Borden. Love You to Pieces. BC, I love you to pieces, but I wouldn't shoot you in the head and bury you in the backyard.
Thank you.
Man. But, Lizzie Borden, you gotta love his different lyrics to his songs. Guitar work, fantastic. Vocals, amazing. And once again, BC, I can't believe you shot her and put her in the backyard, but. You love her to pieces.
I'm surprised nobody did used to love her either.
Yeah.
But I had to kill her. Yeah, that's true. See, it's almost like the same concept.
Yeah.
Again.
That's what made me think of it.
Yeah. Again, the love section is too many to choose from.
Yeah.
True.
Exactly. True. But song number two from Def Leppard, Too Late for Love. This is a desert album.
Mm-hmm.
Desert album for me. It must be a desert album song for me because... I love that album. Love this song. Guitar work is great. Vocals are fantastic. Definitely no skippers on this whole album.
Song number three, Don't Believe in Love from Queensryche. Once again, another one. Iconic. You know, definitely top three. If you don't know Queensryche and you don't know this song, there's something wrong with you living under a rock. Jeff Tate's vocals, fantastic on this. Love these guys. You know, Wrighty, this is Wrighty's band. Just a great, great song. Song number four, Typo Negative. You see, I love you to death.
I love you, but.
I love you to death, but.
But. There's always a but.
I don't know. It's all right. The vocals kind of go all over the place. I don't know.
When I saw when I saw you put this on the list, I'm like, oh, BB's not going to be
here. BB's going to jump all over you. It's all right. It's all right. I love it to death, but no, the vocals are for me. They're just all over the place. It goes like from like low and dark to something that I can't explain. But it definitely, if this was like the Love and War list, this is definitely my war song because I don't like it. but when you go Love Walking from Thunder, this is the best. This is easily the best love song on your list. I love the slow acoustic start, the soft vocals. Then when it fucking kicks in, it kicks in at the with the electric guitar at the chorus. That kicking is amazing. And after that, the band sounds fucking fantastic throughout the song. Love that song. Definitely your highlight of your list. Ready?
Okay. BC, I got to say to you, BB. Come on.
Yeah. That means I'm...
that was a bad.
That was a bad one.
That's a bad. Yeah.
That was the Manjeri Raspberry.
Yeah. I got a bad. That's the first.
I'm gonna go reverse on this one as well. Love Walks In, Thunder. You mentioned it before. We saw these guys twice on the Monsters of Rock cruise. Absolutely, totally pulled this song off live. And you know, I'm not a huge fan of the ballady mid tempo type shit, but great fucking version of the song. Excellent. Definitely enjoyed it. Love you to that Typo Negative. BB, what the fuck is the matter with you? This song is fucking cool as fuck. It's so atmospheric, and it's from the October Rust album. And we actually, and I remember this vividly, we've talked about it before, the day that we went to see the Kiss Worldwide Live, the first reunion tour, BC came at my house like 10 o'clock in the morning. We cracked our first beer. Don't try this at home, even though it was at my home. So we cracked our first beer like fucking 10 o'clock that morning. We made wings at my house, listened to shit all day. This was one of the albums we listened to because it had just come out recently, and we played October Rust to death when that came out because it was not your typical Typo Negative album at the time because there were like 15-minute songs and 11-minute songs and this and that. When October Rust came out, it was more of a compact album, more of... 3-minute songs, 4-minute songs, 5-minute songs, like throughout. So it was a more, cohesive, listenable album where you didn't have like fucking like 5 epic songs on the album. But like "Love You to Death," I thought was just a very cool, atmospheric song. I've always enjoyed that song. It's like a gloomy, atmospheric thing, but it's cool. Am I good enough? And it's got that fuzzy bass type sound. Fucking absolutely love it.
Am I good enough?
As soon as I saw type, I'm like, not. BB's going to fucking hate this. And that's not, it's going to be like him picking an acoustic song.
You ever hear that version? He goes, am I good enough for BB?
For BB.
No, you suck.
Then we go to I Don't Believe in Love. And this is another song that when BC and I first started hanging out and Operation Mindcrime came out, and this was one of the albums that we really bonded over as friends, and I remember right off the bat BC saying I Don't Believe in Love. That was one of my all-time favorite songs, and this was one of the songs that led me to believe he would never be married, because he doesn't believe in love. He never has and never will.
That's true.
Okay, so I think Christy Garmo and Jeff Tate wrote the song, so I think he proved them wrong. Too Late for Love, Def Leppard. There's nothing else I can say about that song. Excellent. Although, the only thing I can say that I wish that Pyromania was as good as Hysteria, but it's not. But
it's
fantastic.
It's still
fucking
a fantastic 1-2 punch.
Absolutely.
Anyway,
absolutely.
It's definitely better than Hysteria.
So I wanted to say Lizzie Borden for last. Because as much of a huge Lizzie Borden fan that BC is, number one, He still doesn't have a Lizzie Borden tattoo, BB.
Yeah, okay? What the fuck?
Game's a be-all, end-all band, okay? I don't know if you've ever thought of that.
I did not.
And he doesn't pick them a lot for stuff on the podcast.
Across the country.
Yeah, he'll talk about them on every episode, but he did not, like, and actually, we may have a Lizzie Borden coming up, maybe, soon.
Hmm.
But he doesn't bring up a lot of stuff for us to talk about song-wise or album-wise on the podcast. So, one, he doesn't talk about them on the podcast album-wise or song-wise. He doesn't have a tattoo. He's got a priest tattoo. He's got a Maiden tattoo, but no Lizzie Borden.
Megadeth,
yes. Huh. So, work on that, motherfucker. Love You to Pieces, title track from debut album. Yeah. Lizzie Borden. But this song, for me, takes a little bit for it to get going.
Yeah.
It does.
Yeah.
But I'll tell you what.
I should have picked my version.
The main thing on this song for me is the melodic soloing on this song.
Their first two albums.
I mean, fantastic. I think they get pigeonholed because of the whole visual thing, maybe Lizzie Borden, whatever. But there's some really good music in there. And this song is proof of it, that they can go outside of that box of the, you know, chopping up the doll in the box and all the crazy shit that they do on the Murderous Metal Roadshow. But this song, like, really showcases the guitar players. It's Gene Allen and
hold on.
He's Matusik?
No,
he's the bass player.
No, I'm sorry. He
Matusik,
he
right?
Tony
Matusik and Gene Allen are the guitar players on this song.
On the album. But he was replaced before the action.
Right. It's a whole Lizzie Borden thing. But this showcases that they are more than just that shock rock thing. The vocals are definitely the shock rock thing. But musically, this song really throws out that melodic part that Lizzie Borden can do when they want to. I like it.
Alex Nelson.
Rest in peace.
Yeah, this was probably my favorite front-to-back love list yours. It was really, really solid. I mean, you have Too Late for Love and I Don't Believe in Love, which are phenomenal songs. How can I not say this is a great list? And Typo Negative, a really good, moody, just trek through this weird place that, of course, I'm always into the weird music shit, so that's right up my alley. I always like Typo, Peter Steele with his dulcet tones. Thunder, Love Walked In, that song kicked ass. The Thunder's a band I have to...
They are so... To me, I think they're so underrated because... Yeah. Their big hit was like Dirty Love, and then I think
that new song they had.
Yeah.
Then this one. Was it
the last one? Last one to Leave the Room or something like that?
Yeah, fucking phenomenal. And Love You to Pieces is a good song. I agree, it does take a little bit to get going. But once it gets there, it's solid for sure. So that, you have my favorite love section.
So BB's out in the cold on that one.
No, he's a close second for sure.
No, I mean like in the song.
Oh, yeah. Typo, yeah. Like as soon as I saw him pick Typo Negative, I'm like BB has
a track. Three out of four podcasters agree.
I forgot about BB not being down with the.
It's like the 9 out of 10.
We listened to what? October Rust?
Was October that Rust, yeah. Great album.
That is a good album. BB would not agree.
I want to say, I think you would like October Rust. You would like October Rust better than Bloody Kisses.
Cinnamon Girl.
I think you would.
I'll have to do
I'm thinking home, birthday. I'm thinking birthday album next year, BB or BC this year.
Okay, let's listen to your love
we'll
list.
We'll do Steel Panther with a Typo Negative.
All right, so I'm going to do my love list now, which I tried to sneak in at the beginning there, which totally fucked it up. I started out with way to go, BC. Wow,
I can't stop.
Dude, you need some fucking. What's that?
I went to say something.
Vino. No, that's just for farts, right? Yeah. Does that count for burps too?
Let's keep going with this. We're running long here. Come on.
That's all right. That's all right.
Damn it.
We're having fun here. All right, I went to 1984, the Boss of the Wall album from Accept, and I'm going with the first song. It's going to be Love Child. Just a cool, semi-deep track from Boss of the Wall. I think they played it on that tour. They played it on the next tour when we saw them. And I think that's a song that they will still throw out occasionally. Just a fun song. BB, it's a love child running wild. Come on. You got to love it. Typical Wolf Hoffman, choppy guitars on it. Cool, except type background vocals, just a fun song. And then I'm going to save the song that I'm going to talk about till last, but I'm gonna skip one here. I'm going to go to 1990, an album that I know BC is very familiar with, the Saigon Kick debut album from 1990. The song Love of God on there. I'll tell you what. This is an album that is so... I don't even know how to describe this, the first Saigon Kick album. It is so eclectic, so weird. There's so many different types of music on there. Like, the guitars are great. The harmonies are fucking unbelievable on this album. And Jason Bieler just put out an album a couple weeks ago. Varen Von Bilski and the Von Bilski Orchestra he put out. If you listen to that album that just came out like a couple weeks ago and put on the newest Saigon Kick album, there's those elements there in a lot of this newer album. But it's just such a... And BC, do you agree that the first Saigon Kick album is such a hard album to describe? You can't say it's a metal album. You can't say it's a hard rock album. You can't say it's a hair metal album. It's just an album of good songs with like stuff you hadn't heard before. This is an album that kind of stands alone in that period.
I think when that came out and I first listened to it, and I was like, wow, this is all over the board.
I was blown away when I first heard this album. And I think I couldn't even tell you what video I saw on Headbangers Ball from these guys. I'm like, this is good. So I'm going to check it out. But, like, there's songs that are all over the place on that Susie? Album.
Might have been Susie.
Yeah. Susie. Yeah. Like, really happy, crappy kind of thing. And then it freaking cranks in. Fucking fantastic. But... For the Love of God, just a cool song. Got great melodies in it. Guitars are fantastic in it. Then I went to 1983, the Fastway album. All You Need Is Love. All you need. But then, you know what I like? The is love. You get the drums, and then it goes into the next part of the chorus. Just a great driving, rocking song. The vocals are fantastic. Absolutely love this Fastway album. Fastway, the first album, might be a Desert Island album for me. I absolutely love it. There's nothing on there that I don't like. It is just a fantastic rock album, front to back. I still don't know why, to this day, that David King, the lead singer of this, will not talk about being in this band. He's the singer for, I always fuck this up, either the Dropkick Murphys or one of those Irish rock bands that play in the club bands. I don't think it's Dropkick Murphys. It's the other one. I can't think of the name right off the top of my head. He will not talk about his time in Fastway. Which I thought they were fucking fantastic. Flogging Molly. That's the song. That's the band. Next song is going to be Yngwie Malmsteen. I had to pick Queen in Love from the Trilogy album from 1986. Always love that album. It's got a great mix of Yngwie's guitars and the keyboards. And it was, I think Mark Bowles is the singer on this. Fantastic song. Always enjoyed this one. And then the last song I'm going to talk about tonight is, which I don't know why, I'm surprised BB did not pick this fucking song. Vinnie Vincent Invasion from 1986, Shoot You Full of Love. I've always liked this album. I know it gets shit on a lot. And this is the song I was talking about before. Totally sick bananas fucking solo that really doesn't fit the song. But he just fucking tears it up just for the sake of fucking tearing it up. in the chorus, it's like, disconnect my telephone. Like, well, that's in like every chorus. I'm like... Who gives a shit if they disconnect your telephone? I really like it. I think it's a cool song. I like the sound of that album. I would really, really love to hear Mark Slaughter sing the vocals on that album. Nothing against Robert Fleischman at all. Right. No disrespect whatsoever. But I would really like to hear Mark Slaughter sing these songs from the first album. And that's a band that, I never got to see. They opened up for Maiden a bunch of times and on the first two tours. A bunch of bands they opened up for, but I never got to see them live, which kind of would have been cool because Vinny's hair was like getting like out of the building. But I really do enjoy the two Vinnie Vincent Invasion albums. But Shoot You Full of Love is my final song on here. Dylan.
Okay, so I really love the bookend tracks, Love Child and Queen in Love. I didn't think I was... I mean, this is a good album for Yngwie, so I don't mind saying that I like this. And it's very strange when you have a playlist and Yngwie's solos aren't the ones on your playlist that don't fit the song.
They're the most insane one, yeah.
Right.
Because the Vinnie Vincent Invasion solos completely ruined that song for me. Because they don't fit at all. It's literally like somebody was playing some country music, and then somebody threw in a rap verse, and then went back to the country. Like, that was the...
BB's going
to
flip the table.
The dissonance for me, because it was such a... Like, I'm listening to the song, I'm like, oh, this is a good song. And then he's like...
It's a shift.
Like, this isn't...
Fucking good.
And this is something I've taken Zach Wilde to task for as well. Play for the song. We know you're a good guitar player. If you want that kind of solo, make that kind of song. You don't put it in the middle of this song, which is like a pretty good mid-tempo rocker. You know, it's going through the paces, and then suddenly... No, it's not for me. Fast Away was good. Suck on Kick, I was like, it's okay. It didn't really pop for me.
I think that's a song you gotta kind of take in the context of the album.
Yeah, I could see that for sure. But it was very good. Besides the very much out of place solo in Vinnie Vincent Invasion.
All right. Tell Dylan how he's wrong, BB.
It's funny because I'll skip Love Child. So I put a heart around Shoot You Full of Love from Vinnie Vincent Invasion, and I go, BB's Sick Banana Solo of the Night.
It's a sick banana.
Yes.
Okay, so it's a great solo, but it's like, it's not even in the ballpark of the song that it's supposed to be in.
That's his middle finger to Kiss. Fuck you, I'm shredding on this album.
Like, it's not that I didn't like the solo. The solo is technically good, but like, so is Zach Wilde solos when he's like shredding on an acoustic song, but like it doesn't fit the song. You gotta service the song. Yeah,
I like it.
There's a time for shredding, there's a time for boosting.
Does it fit? It teeters, but it works. It works, but does it fit? But you have to give Vinny the props. That's a fantastic solo, easily. The best solo out of all these songs. I'll go back to Love Child from Accept. Great opener for side two of their album. Uno's vocals are so, you know, recognizable. Just a great, great sound to these guys. Great German sound. Soloing is fantastic. Love of God from Saigon Kick. It's all right. Not bad. There's some righty loves the woes and the I's. What was the band that went, was that like Duran Duran?
Yeah, with the Reflex, is that what you're
thinking?
That's
it, yeah. When I heard that, I'm like, oh, yeah, that's somewhere.
The Reflex. But
there's some great harmonies in that song, though, but All I Need is Your Love from Fast Way, another great song. Fast Eddie, fantastic guitar work on that song. Definitely love the Yngwie, Queen Love. Like you said, Mark Ballas doesn't get enough for his like vocal performance. He doesn't get enough recognition because like Yngwie's in front of him. But the vocals on that whole album are fucking fantastic. But a very, very good list, Mr. Wright, sir.
All right, except Love Child. Except, I mean, here's a band that even to this very day, I think we talked this episode, how I've listened to their new album. They still keep that distinct except group vocals. But and I was watching YouTube, Uno and his own band. Now who's in that band? I'm very not up to date.
The only ones I know is his son is the drummer.
You could tell that, yeah. He's the youngest.
Other guys, I couldn't tell you one guy.
There's two other guys. I was wondering if they're not. The except of nowadays, currently, how many of those guys are original guys? I'm drawing a blank.
Right now, just Wolf Hoffman.
That's what
because actually, there's three American guys in the band now. There's Christopher Williams, the drummer.
Yeah.
There's Phil Schaus, one of the rhythm guitar players.
Now, yeah.
And there's Mark Toronello on guitar. Peter Baltus was the only other guy, the bass player, that was another original guy.
He's original, but I mean, I think he's Uno guy.
But I
was watching him play at one of these festivals. It's this kid on drums, and two guitar players.
Because there's been a bass couple different guys. There's been a couple different guys.
The two guitar players seem like they might be.
Stefan Hoffman was one. Stefan, that's a man.
I think the one guitar player with him is from Accept.
He may have, yeah.
So, I mean, I watched that live set. They did a lot of early Accept. Cranking. Very good. Saigon Kick, Love of God. I mean, I love this album, so of course I'm going to love this song. I mean, maybe you have to listen to it in the context of the album. I don't know. To me, there's not a bad song on that first album. Fastway. Here's a band that I don't think ever got the respect it should have got. I mean, those albums, the first three albums are great, I think. Even, and then they came out with that one, not recently, but after those first three, it was a while. That was a great album. Anybody mom's name, okay.
We had some thank God it wasn't him singing.
Yeah. I mean, Queen is the Love. This is a great album. You got the keyboards and it's such a powerful. What album is that off of?
It's off a trilogy.
Trilogy. To me, that was one of my back in the day albums. Trilogy Sweet, I was like,
top five?
Mm-hmm. You had to pick up that trilogy. Mom's theme, that was the big thing back in the day.
That's what kicks ass.
Yeah, and there's a live version of that on the Live in Leningrad with Joel Lynn Turner singing it.
Oh, that's cool.
Fantastic. Absolutely fantastic.
The voice of Steel.
So I think we covered that like two or three years ago on the single live album ones. I think that was one that I did. And Joel Lynn Turner's vocals on that because it was on the Odyssey tour. And he sings that song on there. It's fantastic.
Wow. And then the last one, Vinnie Vincent, Shoot You Full of Love. I love the first album. I like Robert's vocals. I mean, you say you want to hear Mark, but I don't know.
I like it, but I would like to hear how different he would sing them songs.
What do you mean?
I don't mind it
if they did it like Danger, Danger did with both vocals, right. Same album.
That'd be cool.
Vocals, that'd be cool. But I mean, the guitar playing is fucking like,
it's insane.
I will bow down and agree with Dylan. It's kind of crazy, it goes off the scale. Not saying it's bad, but it's totally ripping up, and it goes back. You know, I agree. I'll bow down and give that up. But I mean, I love that first album.
I do too.
It's not a bad song, I don't think. Some of the Souls, a little crazy, but hey, he's fucking here. Look at me. I mean, hey, fuck you, Paul.
Gene. Now look at him. Now he can't even play stinking Twinkle, Twinkle, Little Star.
Now he sits up there.
I'm muting was difficult.
How much we have fallen. But anyways, I mean.
Just imagine if he actually continued playing.
All right, Dylan is going to wrap up the love songs tonight.
Okay, saving the most eclectic and probably the most controversial for last. I decided to really branch out on this side, go with songs that we would probably never talk about elsewhere on the podcast, and I figured this would be a good time to bring it in. So the first song on my list, this is a band that's been near and dear to my heart. I first found them out like early 2010s. They I helped kickstart two of their albums, I think, at this point. They did the theme for the show The Goldbergs. So the theme song for that show, that's from these guys. They're like a chiptune rock band, and chiptune is basically the video game music, like using that as backing for the song. So that's why you hear it in this song. They do a cover of Huey Lewis in the News' Power of Love, the band I Fight Dragons. They're just so much fun. And I love the solo that they add to this song. Very good. Packy Lundholm is their guitarist, and he's a fantastic guitarist. And they're fantastic live, too. If you haven't checked them out live, definitely do so. They do some really cool stuff. They do a cover of Never Gonna Give You Up, but they also combine it with the Super Mario theme. So that's, like, really fun. They do a cover of the Legend of Zelda theme. But they have some really awesome songs, and I love their cover of The Power of Love. I think I like it a little better than Huey Lewis because it adds something different, and the solo in it, again, like I said, is fantastic. The next song, this is probably the most format ready for the podcast. Aerosmith from their Nine Lives album, Fallen in Love is Hard on the Knees. This is just a fun song. I love Steven Tyler's delivery in this song. He's got that, like, like at the end of all the verses, some, you know, nice horn section that add a little bit to it. You were gonna pick that song.
That was on my list.
Yeah, it's a good song. I love the album cover too. It's a fantastic album cover. But this was the first Aerosmith album that I remember actively listening to when I was a kid. I remember seeing the album cover and, you know, putting it on and listening to Nine Lives. And this was a song that always jumped out at me. I think it was on my MP3 player for a very long time. The next song, I talked about these guys during one of my listening to, Royal Blood, from their second album, How Did We Get So Dark? I Only Lie When I Love You. Love the groove of this song, especially when they take the riff at the end and they just kind of jam on it. And the drums open up, and I love the when they do the shift into the I only lie when I bum, 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 and they have the little clapping in there, cowbell. There's some cowbell in the song, always iconic. Just a great, great song. The next song, this is probably going to be ripped to pieces by Dad. It's a B-side from one of my favorite musicians, Jack White, formerly of the White Stripes. Cover of U2's Love Is Blindness. Again, I think this is so passionately delivered by Jack. His vocals really get strained with the emotion of the song. Another really awesome, cool solo that is uses the guitar in such a unique way that you don't really see except from Jack White. He makes it squeal, and it's like he's stressing the guitar out to the max, and it really adds for the emotional weight of the song, I think. And then the last song I picked is off of an album that I will forever sing the praises of, Ice Nine Kills, is The Silver Scream, where each song is based off of a different horror movie. Love Bites. Dad, do you know what horror movie this is based off of?
It's got to be from Werewolf in London.
Yeah, it's American Werewolf in London.
American Werewolf in London.
Yep. It's for the point of view of the main character, you know, dealing with the stress of changing into a werewolf and possibly trying not to kill his loved one, his significant other. A really nice duet. The vocals in there are fantastic. It's great when you get to hear him sing clean, because a lot of times there's a lot of their harsher vocals with Ice Nine Kills. But this is a really great ballad. I really enjoy this song. It's such a palate cleanser from the other bombastic stuff on that album, I think. And I thought it would be a perfect way to end my love list and end the love lists of everybody's, I guess. So what do you think? BC, you can go first.
I guess that Dylan always brings the differentness to the table.
Wild card, bitches.
Wild card to the table.
Wild card, bitches!
I fight dragons. I mean, not my cup of tea, but
yeah.
I always give it up to somebody that does cover tunes. I'm a fan of people doing cover tunes of other bands.
Mm-hmm.
So, not bad. Aerosmith falls hard on the knees. I listen to the song. It's good. I checked out after Permanent Vacation.
Yeah.
But listening to this, not bad, not bad. Royal Blood, I mean, another band that I'm totally amazed by, because two guys, I mean,
yep.
When you listen to their music, you're like, this is only two guys, and like you guys saw them live, I mean, and you guys said they pulled it off great.
Oh, they were fantastic.
And that blows my mind away that even live, they pulled, I mean, we can get together and put an album out.
And what blows my mind is that the lead singer, I thought his name was Joe, but it's Mike Kerr, because I thought it was Joe Kerr, but it's Mike. So sorry, continue.
But here's a band that can two guys can pull it off even live. I mean, that says volumes for this band.
Yeah,
Jack White. I'm really not the first time hearing this. I'm really not familiar with Jack White.
Yeah,
I mean. I don't know. I'm being honest.
No, I know. I knew this wasn't going to get a lot of love, so but I wanted to throw it out there.
And the Ice Nine Kills. This is definitely something I want to. I want to get into more.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I love the way they tie in all the.
Yeah. The wordplay is fantastic.
And I'm like, you know, I'm not familiar with a lot of these movies, but this is something I definitely have to get into more.
I recommend that entire album.
Because you're always so talking good. About them, and then I say, you know what, I gotta get it because
I might listen to that.
It's different. I like it. This is different. This is probably the standout on the album.
Cool.
Standout is being new and
yeah,
and something I can see myself getting into.
Nice. BB, what did you think?
All right, Power of Love by I Fight Dragons. I sent Dylan a text today. I'm like, I hope you're fucking happy because I listened to this song like 20 times today. I love this song. I don't know what it is. It just sucked me in. The old cover of the Huey Lewis and the new song. It's just a great kicking in the middle of the song. And then you have like the video sounds, the background that actually you're kind of played in with the music.
Yeah.
The solo is the standout. Like, yeah, I actually enjoyed the sound of the video game sounds.
Yeah.
But then when the solo came, I'm like, wow, that's even better than the background video sounds.
And the cool thing is when they play it live, they have like Guitar Hero controllers that they like play it through, and they'll have like Dance Dance Revolution pads that they'll trigger some of the sounds with, and Game Boys, they'll play with it because you could modify a Game Boy to play those sounds. Like, it's wild stuff. It's crazy what they could do with that.
I'll YouTube them. Hopefully there's like some like live stuff.
I'll send you a live video because there's this one like full concert they do. It's fantastic.
That's cool. Yeah, they that was definitely the surprise of the night for me for I Fight Dragons. Mm-hmm. Fantastic, crazy, different sound. Love it. Song number two, Falling in Love as Hard as I Need by Aerosmith. It's Aerosmith. You know, it's so good. Dylan, you said the horns are in the background, big cymbals, fantastic guitar work, and Steven Tyler's like vocals are just iconic at this time. Song number three, I Only Lie When I Love You from Royal Blood. Once again, two guys, I cannot believe these two guys are making this kind of music. The cool riffs in this song actually really make this song. So, I didn't know the song. I know you talk about Royal Blood. I know they opened up for the Foo Fighters when you guys saw them.
Yep.
But another great tune that I didn't expect to like. Love is Blindness from Jack White.
I knew this was not going to, yeah.
I guess if
is he having an allergic reaction? He's scratching
himself. If the BOC was my piss list, piss song from your list from the war songs, I guess I'm gonna have to go with this song. It's all right. It just didn't grab me. It's probably like the age difference. Mm-hmm. Just nothing really grabbed my ear with that song.
Yeah.
But Love Bites from Ice Nine Kills. I love the female male back and forth duo. Of their vocals. They actually fit really well together. So was that like the whole album?
No, that was just for that song.
Oh, okay. Yeah. But that song, it's really, really ear catching. I love how they went back and forth, but great melodies with their vocals. And not a bad pick, and I said I wanted to indulge more into these guys, but
yeah.
Now I know it's like not male, female back and forth. Yeah. Maybe it's maybe I don't want to indulge, but I will do my homework with these guys. But yeah.
I will warn you, the rest of the album, the vocals are not always that clean.
Oh, okay.
During the courses, they mostly are, but it's a really ripping album. The solos are great. The riffs are fantastic. Mm-hmm. And I think the growly vocals do work for the songs, though.
Because it's not the whole thing.
Yeah, and the wordplay is fantastic. Like,
right.
There's one song where they... they do like it's a Silent Night, Deadly Night, and it's like make sure the noose is Yule tied tight. there's like fa la 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 Feliz Navidad. Like it's so good. Dad, your thoughts? I'm sure that
all right,
could be very interesting.
I Fight Dragons, Power of Love. Once again, I must vehemently disagree with BB. The video game sounds make me want to throw up in this song.
No.
But that's the only thing I really don't like about. Well, not that's not the only thing I like about the song. Where it kind of, there's one part where it kind of slows down that I don't like. I don't think the guy's vocals
they
sound
say that all
good.
They say that all love is fair.
Yeah, part I don't like it in the Huey Lewis version either. But
see, but then it bursts into
but then
the
it
solo.
Kicks in. That's where it kicks
does.
In
I like the kick in, but I just don't like that part. So maybe that makes that part a little better. But the video game sounds. I'm like, why is that in there? Aerosmith, Falling in Love is Hard on the Knees. I just showed Dylan, literally that song is on the flip side of the paper that I'm reading from. This is going to be one of the songs that I picked. I'm like, all right, Dylan, pick this. I'm not going to throw it out there. Love it. I think Nine Lives is hands down the best Aerosmith song post permanent vacation. Mm-hmm. Easily. There is some kick-ass shit on that album. Falling in Love is Harder Than Knees is fucking fantastic. Steven Tyler's vocals are great. The guitars are fantastic. It's a I don't even know who produced the album. It's produced fucking fantastic. I Only Lie When I Love You, Royal Blood, great band. I like the groove to the song. And I even have it written down. Cowbell is very cool in it. Love is Blindness, Jack White. Well, it's a weird song, but it's got a very Doors feel to me.
The keyboards at the beginning.
I think the solo is really cool. It's like a really fuzzed out type solo in it. I don't hate it. I don't love it, but I don't hate it.
Yeah.
But the solo is really cool, and it has that has like a Doors feel for me. What do we got next? Love Bites, Ice Nine Kills. This might be one of my favorite songs tonight.
Wow.
And I'm not a huge ballad guy, but it's cool because I'm like, holy shit, this is about American Werewolf in London.
Yeah.
Because, cool movie. I don't know if anybody out there has seen the movie. I'm sure a lot of people have. I don't know if you guys here have.
Yep.
Very cool, but I like the, like, you kind of have to know the movie to really get into how the lyrics are with him singing and the girl singing
they
back.
They do a good job about how not the flesh stopping is on intellectual property.
Tender and stuff. I mean, it's cool. I mean, it's really cool, but it's even without that, it's a good song.
Yeah,
the vocals are really cool with the I couldn't name the guy or the girl, whatever, who's singing.
Yeah,
but it's a really good back and forth. It's no Ebony and Ivory, BB.
No, it's not that, but nothing
could be that. But it's really good. I like it. That was probably my surprise of the night. I have heard it before, but I really had never paid attention to it. But they're a band that I'm actually looking forward to checking more out of. Mm-hmm. And that's really pretty much one of the main things of doing stuff like this. I'm hoping, and I hope we're all hoping, that someone picks something different that no one's heard before, another band, another album to check out. And that's really what we want to do to get our listeners interested. You know, check out something different. Get out of your comfort zone, try something different. Sometimes it may work, sometimes it may not. But like the ones that work, you're like, holy shit! And especially a band, if it's a band that has a large catalog, or that's what she said.
Whoa.
Or something like that, that it'll give you a lot more stuff to check out.
Yeah.
That's what I like about this. That like a song like that will make me want to listen to Ice Nine Kills even more than I already have.
Well, you can listen to the live album that it will eventually come in on vinyl. But
I do have good news for you, Dylan. Yeah. I literally got an email today.
Okay, that's good.
That album has shipped. I think it was October 9th. I ordered this double live album, Ice Nine Kills, for Dylan. October 9th, 2020, for Dylan, for Christmas.
To be fair,
I literally got the
email
today that it has shipped.
You got it for Christmas. Not,
so
not what year.
I mean, you may be enjoying it on the 4th of July, but it's on the way.
Also,
halfway to Christmas.
You want to know who produced Nine Lives? Kevin Shirley.
Hmm. The Caveman. There you go. Yep. Hmm. I didn't know that.
Yep.
Sweet. Okay. So
no Andy Sneap, but close.
Hey, he's
Kevin Shirley's a good.
That's
close
all right.
Second.
He's up. He's up there though. Yeah. He did Rush, Mate. You can't
come wrong. He's good.
Black Country Communion.
Ooh, BCC.
All right, guys, so I hope you guys enjoyed this. I know we went a little bit long today, but I frankly don't care because I want to make sure that we give it. Huh?
Frankly, my dear, I don't give a damn.
Yeah, I want to make sure that everybody gets their chance to talk about their songs and everybody gets to talk about everyone else's songs. But I like doing this stuff. Like I said before, that it's cool that we picked some stuff, like some of the stuff that we all picked, we were all familiar with. Some of the stuff we were not. But I hope that like brings about something that will interest someone in checking more out of a band. So we'll go around and we'll wrap up. Dylan.
I had a really fun time putting this list together. I really enjoyed what everybody brought to the table. If I had to pick like a person's list overall to like go back and listen to, I think because BC put a lot of the hits that I know, I'm gonna go with BC, but everybody really put out great lists. Everybody has some fantastic songs on each of the lists that I really enjoyed. Some surprises, some songs that I already knew. So it was great listening to all the stuff. And you can listen to all of our songs on the Spotify playlist of the week that we already mentioned. That'll be in the show notes. And let us know what Love or War songs you wanna spotlight, because of course we couldn't hit every single song about love in the history of hard rock and heavy metal. Do you know how many ballads there are alone with the song Love in it? We want to hear what you think is a good song that features love or war as the title or the theme, because we couldn't cover them all. I'm sure we'll have another episode similar to this or the same topic, and we could come up with a million more. Maybe not war. There's actually surprisingly little war songs.
There was.
That
I was very surprised.
That really jump out at you for metal, but exactly. I'm sure if we dig
next
deep
year,
enough.
Maybe Love and Hate.
There you go. Yeah.
Love that band.
We could feature Hate from Kiss.
That was not that bad.
And Love Theme
one
from
of these. Don't pick War Machine.
One of the decent songs from Carnival Songs.
Yeah, definitely a great episode, great topic. Happy Valentine's Day, you sons of bitches.
Yep.
But definitely a fantastic list from all you guys. You know, and like Steve said, that's kind of why I kind of threw something in that we're really not used to listening to, like Fatal Smile and Fifth Angel. They're just to get their name out there and say, oh, wow, I never heard them before. You know, maybe I'll download an album and kind of give them a, you know, check them out. You know, old, like I've been saying since episode one, like old music could be new music to somebody. And definitely those two bands are definitely new music to somebody out there who's not actually heard of them. But a great episode, great topic. You know, everybody's list was fantastic. And like BC said before, like the war songs were tough. And we could have had five episodes on the love ones, but everybody had great lists and great debates.
Another fun episode. I mean, like sitting down to do this. I mean, I knew BB and Steve would be pretty much in my familiar wheelhouse, but Steve had one that was like, and BB had one that I'd never heard of before. And then there's always the wild card. And this is why I always say this, and I say this to him blue in the face, that Dylan is the wild card. He brings that
odd wow factor.
That odd spice to the mix that we have here. And there's always something that stands out. And there's always something that leaves you wanting a little bit more. And you know what? I should check that out a little bit more. And I always say that, no matter what we're talking about, especially this episode. But overall, great one, and happy Valentine's Day, everybody.
All right, yeah. Happy Valentine's Day, bitches out there. If you're in love, more power to you. If you're not,
happy Valentine's bitches out there.
You'll find it some. Bitches?
You'll find it.
You'll find it someday.
Absolutely. Yeah, I had fun doing this episode, and I think Dylan got a new nickname today, Wild Card.
I'm the Charlie Kelly.
Which
of the podcast.
usually me.
Instead of wild thing, you're wild card.
Yeah, I like that. I like that. And I do like Dylan's different perspective that he does bring to this podcast. I've said it
it's
many times. We all have.
Okay, yeah. It's the age difference.
Yeah,
yeah.
Like I mean, we're somewhat close, but in
we're know, old crotchety fucks, and he's a young he's dude. A young you know, so giving us a check out different shit. Change our perspective on stuff, and I like that, and that's and I said that before. Like I really, I think that makes our podcast unique. That there's four of us, and we're all together, and so like when we're talking about something, like I could be talking about a band, and BB hates them, and he's flipping me off, or shaking his head to BC, or Dylan's like, "What the fuck are you talking about?" type thing. But we can all see that. I really like the dynamic when we're all here. And it's definitely a different dynamic when it's like just three of us or two of us or sometimes even one of us. And I really like my favorite podcasts are when it's just the four of us here. And honestly, no disrespect for any guests we have, but this is I love this. This is cool. This is our virtual group hug here. But
yes.
It's a blast. I had a good time doing this one. And like maybe next year, maybe we'll do like Love and Hate. And you think war songs were hard to find.
The
hate songs might
train.
Be even harder. I don't know.
Yeah. We got Hate Train for Metallica.
Godsmack.
Love's
Those yeah, I mean, you can do a ton of shit with that. But like, we do have a ton of good shows coming up because I literally have a list in front of me the shows that we're doing up until the end of April. So we have a lot of cool shit, a lot of cool returning guests coming on, cool topics, some shit we haven't visited in a while. Our buddy Mr. Random Thought will be on in a couple of weeks. Guy only knows the fuck he's gonna say. But and actually, we have a new thing coming up that Dylan came up with that I think is going to be really, really cool as well. And so, like, thank you guys out there for listening. You know, we love you guys, appreciate you guys.
Also, the return of an old favorite.
Yes, next week.
That we talking about? Yeah, is it next week or the week after? We're
old favorite episode.
Old favorite.
Well, I thought
episode.
You meant person.
Oh, yeah.
Old favorite.
I wouldn't call him old.
Well, he's old. Actually, he's older than all of us. He may be the oldest person we've had on this podcast. So we'll ask that next week. I know he's older than all of us, but I can't think of he's got to be older than everybody we've had on this podcast so far.
Maybe not one.
Maybe yeah. Ooh. Maybe not the drummer.
Oh yeah. You're right. So second oldest.
What about Bill?
Guy. Third
oldest.
Oh,
yeah, Bill.
Wow. Check your facts before you...
Come on! Come on! I'm just throwing shit out here.
How about oldest of the local people?
No, he's not. He's... Oh, my God. His neighbor's older.
Anyways.
I'm going to shut up.
What are you going to say to Dylan? Shut the fuck up.
Shut the fuck up.
So, you guys, thank you for listening, and I hope everybody's doing good out there during all this, you know, this turmoil. I know in the United States we're having a rough time with all the bullshit that's going on. Hope everybody out there is, you know, doing well, you know, like mentally. I hope everybody out there is just like, you know, if you need to, you know, to get something off your chest or talk to someone, like, talk to someone. Seriously, don't let things build up. Get out there. You know, if you think you're losing it, talk to a friend, get some professional help. You know, we just had something happen here with, you know, someone that we know, very, very tragic. We want everybody out there to, you know, get out there, enjoy life. If you think you're having problems, you think you're losing it in something like that, just, you know, talk to someone. And even if you're out there, be nice. You could be the person that makes that person not do something that they don't want to do. You could, you know, and if you're a dick, you could be that person that fucking pushes someone over the edge. So be nice, seriously. You guys are going to push me over the edge one of these days, but that's
you know, but we'll be nice.
That's a foregone conclusion.
We'll be nice about it.
I think we have to take a page out of the great philosophers, William S. Preston Esquire and Ted Theodore Logan. Be excellent to each other.
Be excellent to each other. Absolutely, yeah. So be cool out there. Don't be a dick. Be nice. Like I said, if you're an asshole, you could be that person that pushes someone over the edge. But if you're that nice person, you could be someone that brings them back from that edge. So I hope everybody's doing good out there. Hope everybody is just like being cool about this stuff and doing what they're supposed to be doing, the social distancing, the wearing the masks, washing your hands. Even if you don't believe in it, don't be an asshole out there. Just, you know, do what you got to do. Be cool. We love you guys. We want everybody here to have fun with us. We appreciate you guys. We love you guys listening. BC, you are full of fucking gas tonight. Holy fuck.
It's got to be the PBR.
It's got to be. See, when you drink shit beer, you get the burps like that. So, guys, thank you for listening. Like I said, we love you guys, and thank you for listening. Take care of yourselves and each other. We will see you next time, and there definitely will be a next time.